and Garrison Schwartz in right field.
Good afternoon and welcome to Brazel Stadium. Michael Potter and Fletcher Like with you for GCU Baseball, the Lopes and the Dons. The Lopes trying to salvage one game of this three-game series. GCU comes in at 3-8 on the year. The Dons at 10-5. You know, Fletcher, they got Jake Repovich on the mound for GCU. In this one, you see him making his warm-up tosses, and he gets the task of trying to right the ship here. A 13-6 loss to the Dons, and then an 11-8 loss. The Lopes give up 5 runs in the 9th inning. The Dons came back and stole one yesterday, so it's up to Repovich to get a good quality start and give the Lopes a chance to at least get one game in this 3-game set before heading onto the road.
Yeah, Repovich needs to do what he does and has done all season long. Talking to Coach Stankiewicz before the game, Jake just needs to be Jake, as he said. Andy Stankiewicz saying Jake just needs to throw the ball up in the zone, bring it in and out, up and down in the zone, change the eye levels of pitchers. His sweeping slider and a good changeup are going to be his two secondary pitches, along with his fastball that he really locates well, and he can keep the San Francisco Dons batters off balance if he can do those things well today.
The Dons playing very well, as you can imagine. 10 wins on the season, one of their best starts in the last decade. And as a team, they hit the ball pretty well, .284 batting average. Repovich, when you look at his numbers, a 4.08 ERA, a record of 1-1. And he has started 3 games, so this will be his 4th start. And 17 2/3, he's given up 21 hits, 8 runs. They were all earned. He's walked 5 and struck out 14. And he'll start against Matt Sinatro, the left fielder, the senior, Nico Giaritano, the switch-hitting shortstop, and Ross Puskarich, the junior first baseman, the first 3 to face him. And then Dominic Maroglio, the catcher who had the 2-run shot to tie the ball game up or to give them the 2-run lead last night. He's on deck, being the number 4 hole hitter in this one. First pitch in there for a strike 1. John Flanagan behind home plate. Lopes have had a few issues with Flanagan out in the field, but he's behind the dish here. Robert McKinley at first and Stephen Barga at third. We'll get you the defensive alignments in a moment here. Sinatro. So lefty-lefty matchup. That one catches the outside corner, so no balls and 2 strikes. Sinatro, the only true lefty in this lineup. A couple of switch hitters. Quinn Cotton in left, Kona Quigle in center, Garrison Schwartz in right, Zach Malice at third, Mark Mumper at short, Austin Bull at second, and Ian Evans at first. Jared McDonald behind the plate. Griffin Barnes getting the afternoon off. The 0-2. Waste one down low. Sinatro wouldn't chase. And the count is 1-2. Sinatro's been pretty good ball player here so far this season for the Dons. You look at the batting average, maybe not so much there, but 13 hits on the season and scored 13 runs.
Yeah, he's got 3 RBIs as well in the series, hitting 5-for-9 with 6 runs scored.
To short, Mumper's got the first chance at it. Fires a little high, but in time, Evans able to make the grab. Mark Mumper out there at short. Retired Sinatro, 6-3 on the putout. That'll bring up Nico Giaritano. Now, Giaritano has been a killer against GCU, mainly from the left side, though. He's a switch hitter, so we'll see him bat from the right side. Probably only, the second or third time in this series, I think. Well, actually, it might be the first time in the series that he's actually come up and hit from the right side. But, boy, he's been doing a lot of damage for the Dons. First pitch from Rep into right. Gary's got a beat on it. Makes the grab. That's a way to get it done. One pitch and one out. I'm sure we'll talk more about Giaritano as the game progresses, but boy, 367 batting average and just really the captain of the team out there defensively.
Yeah, he's a guy that's been on the team for a long time. Coach's son, he's a seasoned player. He brings a lot of experience and leadership to this Dons team, that the Dons team that needs that and will carry that into the West Coast League play.
Yeah, those coaches' kids, man, they always know the game, understand the game. Ross Puskarich at the plate, first pitch in there for a strike. Boy, this is a fantastic start for Repovich, getting ahead of every batter that he's faced here and really painting those corners. You mentioned moving the ball up and down, in and out. So far, so good.
Yeah, he needs to set the tone early here for GCU and be a leader as a junior on this team after 2 losses to the Dons late in games, and be a leader for the bullpen as well, starting the game strong.
That one just a bit inside, 1-1. The count. Puskarich hitting .364 on the year, has 20 hits in 55 at-bats, no homers and 9 RBI. Little squibber under the glove of Repovich. That is going to be trouble, not a fast runner, but no play there for Bull. Once that got under Rep's glove, that was going to be an infield single. Even though Puskarich doesn't really necessarily burn it down the line, long way to go for Bull. So base hit single with 2 outs.
Yeah, really awkward hit there right off the hands. Jammed him a little bit there, and ball was able to squib underneath the glove of Repovich. Unlucky there.
Yeah, Maroglio at the plate now, the junior catcher. He's the DH in this ball game. And you look at his numbers, 241, not really hitting the ball great. But, boy, he missed an entire season last year with a hand injury. Played in the summer, but he's talking to his coach, Nino Giratano. He said, you know, he's really just kind of getting comfortable back at the plate 14, 15 games into the season. Throw over. Would they get him? They got him. Wow. Well, exactly what you don't want to do if you're the Dons. You got your big bopper up who just did a two-run blast the night before, and you get picked off first, and you're not really even trying to steal a bag. I mean, Puskarich hasn't stolen all year, but Repovich, the crafty lefty, gets a couple outs and then picks the man off at first base, and the Lopes retire the side. So no runs on one hit. There were no errors and nobody left on base. We go to the bottom of the first. Lopes trying to do what they did the first two games, get a run across in the first and take a lead. No score here as we go to the bottom of the first at Brazos.
Get the best gear to show off your Lope pride. Go to lopeshops.gcu.edu to find everything GCU, from the newest apparel to the coolest accessories. Use promo code GCUTV20 to get 20% off for being a GCU TV viewer. Let's paint the valley purple. Lopes up.
Sam Granoff on the hill, getting ready to go for the Dons. Granoff, the 6'5", 195-pound redshirt junior left-handed pitcher. And Granoff, a 3.6 ERA, a record of 1-1 in third appearance here on the season. In 10 innings, he's given up 7 strikeouts and 5 walks. So Granoff, your pitcher here. And he will face Austin Bull, the second baseman, switch hitter. Greg Sines at the DH batting second. Ian Evans will bat third and play first base. Garrison Schwartz down in the cleanup spot, left-handed batter, and playing right field. Quinn Cotton, the freshman in left, bats fifth. Zach Malice, the third baseman, bats sixth. Kona Quiggle in center, bats seventh. Jared McDonald getting the start behind the plate here in this one, bats eighth. And Mark Mumper, your shortstop, bats ninth. So Bull, Sines, Evans, Schwartz, Cotton, Malice, Quiggle, McDonald, and Mumper. And Granoff, actually, I read the wrong stats here. Granoff, a 4.7 ERA, a record of 1-2. This is his fourth appearance in 15 and a third. He's given up 13 hits, 11 runs, 8 earned. He's walked 10 and struck out 9. A record, opponent's hitting 241 against him. He has been tagged for a couple of long balls, 2 home runs on the season. Fletcher and the Lopes, they scored runs in the first inning the last two games. They just couldn't punch any more than one across. See if they can put a crooked number on the board here in the first inning.
Yeah, they've been able to slap the ball around both series, this series and the St. Mary's series. They just haven't been able to come up with any W's and take the series. And GCU's going to need to use a big bat from Austin Bull early and the entire game if they're going to be able to take this game successfully from the Dons.
Yeah, Bull having a series here in this one as he steps up against Granoff, and he'll hit from the right side, takes the first pitch, a strike. So we had righties going the first two games, Goodman and Hart in game one, Slominski and Wong in game two. Now we got a couple of lefties on the hill. Whenever you say lefties, you almost have to say crafty lefty, you know? Unless he's just a blazer. This kind of goes with it. Ooh, swings through that off-speed pitch. So Bull down the count, no balls and two strikes.
Crafty lefty that's thrown two straight breaking balls here to start the count off here against Bull.
Bull hitting 364 on the year. No homers, 3 RBI, following up that great freshman campaign. And in this series, hitting 625. 5 hits already as he pops that one foul. Just grounds it toward the dugout. Scored 3 runs, an RBI. Played shortstop game one and second base game two. And here at second base again today. Outfield normal depth straight away. The 0-2 to Bull. Right center field. That one might get down. It does. So Bull once again. Another base knock. He is just having a great series. 6th base hit in 9 at-bats. And he's on board once again. He did it in the first two games. Base hit singles to get things going. We'll see if the Lopes can do it. In game one on Friday night, Bull got a base hit single. And Sines, the number two hitter, followed it with a base hit single. And then Garrison Schwartz ground out and drove a run in.
Saw a lot of pitches there, a lot of breaking balls there from Granoff to start things off, and then he got a pitch that you really liked. They will put it in the gap there for a single.
Bull prancing around down there at first base. Lopes is going to play small ball. The bunt's down. Ping, the throw over to first in time. So Andy Stankiewicz goes sacrifice bunt right out of the chute here. Sines lays it down. The sack bunt 5-3 on the put out. And that brings Bull into scoring position. And Ian Evans at the plate. Evans has been the number four hitter. They moved him up a slot against the lefty here. And Ian Evans hitting 333 on the year with a homer and 10 RBI.
I like Evans in the three spot a little bit more than the four spot. He's going to be able to put guys, he's going to be able to move guys around the bases using his bat. And I think he can do that a little bit better in the three spot rather than the four spot.
Well, the Lopes have been scoring runs since, you know, basically after the Wichita State series. They've been scoring runs. Just haven't been able to get the pitching and the defense to align as that one's in there for a strike. But Evans, a huge part of that, and he hits 357 against lefties so far. It's not a lot of at-bats, but he's seen the ball really well from the lefties.
Yeah, you get a little bit more time to see the ball, being able to see the ball from that left arm as a right-handed batter.
Popped up, but that's going to get out of play. So Granoff doing a nice job, very similar to what we saw Repovich doing, getting ahead of the first couple batters that he's faced. Bull just able to fight a couple off and then find one he could shoot out into right center field for the base hit.
Yeah, look for a breaking ball here from Granoff. He really likes to throw breaking balls when he's ahead in counts, even to start things off in a count. And most likely a breaking ball here ahead in the count 0-2.
Taking a look at Bull. Not a huge lead there. Second baseman Perry keeping him close. Misses outside. Defensively, Sinatra in left. Villaroman in center. Brady Bate in right. Aaron Ping gets to start at third base for the Dons. It had been Alan Smoot the first two games. Nico Giratano at short, Michael Perry at second, Ross Puskarich at first, and then Riley Helland gets to start behind home plate. The 1-2 fouled off by Evans. Well, yesterday's lineup was an interesting lineup at the top two. You had Bull leading off with Garrison Schwartz jumping up against the righty into that number two hole, then Evans and Cuba Bess and Malice, and so you really had five guys in there that can really swing the stick. With a lefty on the hill, Cuba Bess is on the bench, and Sines gets in there in that DH role, and they drop Schwartz down to the number four hole.
Yeah, top half of the lineup had all the hits from last night's game.
Breaking pitch that stayed up. Foul ball given chase. Bate runs out of room down right field. Yeah, the bottom third struggled a bit in that ball game yesterday. That was Quiggle, Barnes, and Mumper. We're combined 0 for 13 in that one.
It's tough to win ball games when you're not getting hits and not getting base runners from the bottom half of your lineup. If you can get guys from the bottom third of your lineup on base, the top of the lineup are the guys that are going to be able to drive those guys in, and that's how you're going to win a ball game, a complete roster rather than just the top half of it. That's how you win ball games.
Granoff taking some time here with the runner on. Ready to go now, the 1-2. Bull extending that lead. There he goes. He got a good jump. And with two strikes, Evans had to protect, fouls it off. But, boy, Bull had a nice jump there. I think that had that pitch been a ball and Evans could have taken it, that would have been a straight steal of third.
And Evans would have been able to block the throw from the catcher a little bit. Can't move in the batter's box. But it would have been a tough throw there for Helland from home with that right-handed batter there in Evans.
Yeah, and we'll keep an eye on that with Helland behind the plate now instead of Marolio. Marolio on that 2017 Johnny Bench watch award list, really good arm. And with him on the bench, maybe they think they can extend that running game a bit against Helland. 1-2 count once again. Trying to keep him closer out there. Fouled off again. Evans having a nice at-bat here, just staying alive on those pitches that Granoff doing a good job of placing him just out of the zone, but Ian's got to stay alive. He's making contact. Is fouling those off. I do want to correct one thing I said. I said they were 0 for 13. They were 0 for 12, the bottom third, because I don't want to short Mark Mumper. He got a base on balls his last at bat. So he did reach base. Does that make it sound any better? 0 and 13, 0 and 12? Bottom third's got to produce. You know they weren't happy with that outing. That one ripped. It's going to get down. Cut off by the center fielder, but Bull's going to swing around and score easily from second. And for the third game in a row, the Lopes bring Austin Bull home to score the first run of the ball game in the bottom of the first, 1-0 GCU.
Great at-bat there from Evans to stay alive. Down the count early, 0-2. Fouled off a bunch of pitches, and then was able to line that one into the left center gap and bring home Bull, who had a big and good jump at second base.
You know, it's interesting as Garrison Schwartz steps up to the plate here. The Granoff was really making some great pitches, but boy, if you can just keep extending these guys, it's tough to make 5-6 great pitches in a row. You're going to get one that stays up or catches a little too much of the plate, and that's exactly what Bull did in the first at bat and Evans did in the third at bat of the ballgame.
That's exactly what I was about to say, Michael. Able to see just one pitch, and that's all you need is just one pitch, good pitch. You see it, you drive it somewhere. That's what Bull and Evans have been able to do.
That one missed outside 2-0. Yeah, and that's really the difference between the good hitters and the not-so-good hitters is when you get that one or two good pitches in that bat, you do something with it. And Evans, so far this year, has been doing that. When he gets a good pitch to drive, he and Bull both have been making good, solid contact. Gary's still trying to get going up high, 3-0. Garrison Schwartz, the preseason WAC Player of the Year, been scuffling a bit, 209 batting average with one homer and seven RBI. Looked like he got it going a bit up at St. Mary's, but it's been a bit of a struggle, and it was last year too, but boy, he finished strong last year, and he's having trouble getting out of the gates here again.
He's an everyday player that you just keep plugging into the lineup, and eventually the good things are going to happen, and then he's a guy that once the train starts rolling, it's really, really hard to stop it.
3-0 count here. You give him the green light, 3-0. Maybe we can take one. Granoff hasn't even been close. And that one in there for a strike. Even if he had the green light, that's not one of the ones he would have gone after as a nice fastball in the outside corner. So now Gary's ready to go here. We've seen three starters. This is the third starter, and two of the starters for the Dons have had Tommy John surgery in their careers, and this guy's one of them. Missed all of 2016 due to Tommy John surgery. Up high, and he walked him. Granoff thought he caught the top edge of the zone, but home plate umpire John Flanagan said no such luck. So now runners at first and second, and Quinn Cotton at the plate.
I thought that pitch was close, but Flanagan decided not to call that one a strike, and it's going to put runners on first and second. Good at bat there from the right fielder and Garrison Schwartz.
Yeah, that was a tough take. That looked pretty good from up here, but, you know, Gary taking it. Didn't want to get under it and pop it up, so first and second. They're not holding Garrison on down there either at first, so we'll get a pretty nice jump here. Cotton at the plate, first pitch, breaking pitch in there for a strike. And Quinn Cotton, one of those freshmen, getting a lot of playing time, struggling a bit, hitting 118 on the year, no homers, one RBI, really pressed into action with the injury to Preston Pavlica. And Cotton now basically the starting left fielder as long as they have to wait for Pavlica to get back in the lineup.
Two freshman outfielders for GCU because of two injuries and two guys that Stankiewicz and GCU really need in the lineup if they're going to be successful long-term and down the stretch into the WAC play in Thomas LaRouge and Preston Pavlica. But Cotton and Quigley are holding their own here, and they've had glimpses of stellar play.
Yeah, Tommy, last year they only got to start and play in all 54 games for GCU, and that's a big loss. Tried to check his swing going around. Didn't even have to look down. That's funny. The freshman Cotton goes, you didn't even going to ask? But the home plate umpire says, no, you went around, man. I don't even have to ask on that one.
Granoff's come with a first pitch breaking ball and a second pitch breaking ball to three of the four right-handed batters here for GCU, and he's gotten ahead in the count early in every single one of those at-bats against right-handed batters.
Yeah, that seems to be his pitch he's most comfortable with, the 1-2. Down the right field line, that slicing foul, and it's going to get out of play, so the count stays at 1-2. It'll be interesting to see if he does that through the first time through the lineup, he switches it up second time through, or if he's just a guy who feels really comfortable throwing that first pitch breaking ball.
He looks really comfortable throwing that first pitch breaking ball, specifically to right-handed batters. He didn't throw a first pitch breaking ball to Garrison Schwartz, a left-handed batter, so maybe that's his game plan right now, is go with that first pitch breaking ball, knowing guys are probably going to take on a first pitch breaking ball, maybe even on a first pitch fastball, and hope that he doesn't leave a fastball over the plate, because a breaking ball you're most likely not going to swing on.
The 1-2. In the air, right center field. Going back to make the grab is Villa Roman. Runner at second is going to tag and go down to third easily. That's Evans. So now runners at the corners with a couple of outs, and it'll be Zach Malis coming to the plate. So Garrison stays put. Evans moves up on the fly out to right. Malis at the plate. Malis, the everyday third baseman for GCU. Another one of those guys you mentioned there. Some of those guys, you just kind of pencil them into the lineup and leave them. And he seems to have taken over that third base role. Last year it was at first base, but he's made the switch across the diamond and playing really well down there at third. Malis at the plate now with the chance to plate another run. And this is really where the Lopes struggled the first two games. They had the bases loaded yesterday in the first inning. Only got one run. Bases loaded, nobody out. Only got one run across. They really need to get a nice two-out base hit here. Is once again the breaking ball for a strike. I mean, you see the Dons in their scoring. A lot of big numbers in the innings. It's really putting the pedal to the metal. The Lopes sometimes okay with just that one run, you know, and it chance to really put the pressure on the Dons. Might have got under that one too much, and he did. Out to right. Bate makes the grab, and as we mentioned, just one run across. Six come to the plate, and the Lopes, though, only get one run on two hits. There were no errors, and two men left on base. We've completed one. 1-0 GCU. This is Lopes Baseball on GCU TV.
Finding the right college isn't always simple. The choices I make today affect where I'll be tomorrow. That's why I chose Grand Canyon University. Here I'm working toward a greater purpose and a place that feels like home. With scholarships to help me earn my degree, I can graduate in less than 4 years. By attending GCU, Arizona's premier private Christian university, I know I'm not just making the right choice, I'm making the smart choice.
Find your purpose at Grand Canyon University. Private, Christian, affordable. Visit gcu.edu.
Repovich out there for inning number two. He's got a 1-0 lead, but once again, the Lopes get back-to-back base hits to start the ball game, or leadoff base hit, and then back-to-back base hits the first two. The Signs had the sack bunt, then a base hit by Evans in this ball game, but basically, Fletcher, they're getting that one run across in the first inning of each of these three games, but unable to put more runs across, and really wasted opportunity there with runners in scoring position, only one out, and you don't get one run across.
It's a good start, but if you want to be a next-level program with runners in scoring position with one out or no outs like GCU's had here against San Francisco, you have to be able to put more runs on the board in the first inning. You have to keep the pressure on the Dons if you want to be successful long-term and down the stretch late into the ball game and not give up those big innings like GCU has here against the Dons this series.
Maroglio, Perry, and Ping do up. The way this series has gone, one run's not going to get the job done, so you're going to need him again. Repovich pitched really well in that first inning. It was Maroglio who was at the dish as he takes that first pitch a strike. When Ross Puskarich, who had just singled, was picked off first base, he didn't even have that big of a lead. Almost looked like he just kind of fell asleep, and Repovich picked him off, left Maroglio with the bat in his hand, 1-1 the count. If you remember, as soon as he got picked off, Maroglio just kind of dropped the bat and put his hands on his hips like, are you kidding me, dude? I just hit a two-run shot my last time up. You're not going to give me a crack at it here? You're going to get picked off? The 1-1. Way inside, Maroglio really pulled back from that, but that a little bit closer than maybe he thought. Just a bit inside with the fastball. 2-1 the count to Dominic Maroglio. Maroglio hitting just 246 on the year, but four homers and 10 RBI. All kind of power. Boy, squares that one up. Coming in and making the grab, though, is Quiggle. He's hit some really hard balls this series, but just a two-run homer to show for it.
A lot of power. It's a really hard ballpark to get the ball out of. Those big, tall walls out in the outfield, except for in right field. 375 and 380 to the gaps. It's a tough ballpark to get a ball out of here, especially when the wind's not blowing like it is today.
First pitch swing and Perry. Oh, barehanded by Malis. Makes the throw and nice footwork on the other end by Evans to go into the foul territory and grab that one. Boy, you see guys try to do that barehand. And a lot of room for error on that, but Malis made it look easy. Get the little squibber off the bat of Perry, and there's two down.
I really like the fact that he set his feet instead of trying to make that throw on the run. It looked like he was going to try to make the throw on the run, but he decided to set his feet and then was able to get a bunch more power behind the ball and was able to throw it over to Evans there. But a great play there by Alice at third base.
Aaron Ping at the plate, hitting 263 with one homer and three RBI. Two outs here in the top of the second. Fastball in the outside corner for a strike. Boy, McDonald might have got himself a call there with the frame of that ball. Looked a bit wide, but gets the call. Once again, Repovich working ahead of the batters here.
Repovich likes to work quickly and fast out on the mound, and he's been doing that here so far against the Dons, and he's got a lot to show for it, too.
Right side. Evans going over, but it's going to drift down the outfield in foul territory. Schwartz makes the grab, and that's the inning. A nice little 1-2-3 inning. So through two, no runs, just one hit. That was back in the first inning. And the Lopes lead it 1-0 as we go to the bottom of the second here at Brazos State. And believe the bottom third of the order, Quiggle, McDonald, and Mumper coming up for the Lopes.
GCU now offers a unique opportunity to earn your doctorate through an on-campus evening cohort. Doctorate programs in education and in philosophy are enrolling now. Scholarships are available. The next evening cohort begins this month. For more information, visit gcu.edu/doctoral2017. Cohort classes are just one night a week, so they're very convenient, and GCU is offering new programs all the time.
Well, Granoff taking his warm-up toss as he kind of starts the warm-up tosses between innings, kind of like Trevor Bauer does, where he stands on the back of the mound and takes like two crow hops and, you know, throws as hard as he can a couple of times, and then he gets on the mound to take his tosses in earnest. Granoff, one of those guys, he missed the entire season last year due to Tommy John surgery after a West Coast Conference all-freshman year, his first year, and the starter, Grant Goodman, on Friday night, he didn't play in 2015. He missed that due to Tommy John surgery. So two of their three starters have already undergone the Tommy John surgery. But Fletcher, we've seen it through all ranks of baseball. Some guys can come back and be just as good, if not better, after Tommy. It doesn't always happen, but a lot of times in this day and age it does.
Yeah, it's an injury that and a surgery that can be scary for a lot of players because they don't know how they're going to come back. They don't know if they're going to come back better. They don't know if they're going to come back without the exact same kind of play that they had before. But what we will see here from Granoff and Goodman here soon in the next couple of years, how that affects them.
Ripped by Quiggle, leading it off in the second. So Lopes had lead-up man aboard once again. Going to Quiggle. Well, he hits .750 on the year. Now he hits higher than that against lefties. The switch hitter rips one into left. Jared McDonald. Now, last time this happened, just an inning ago, leadoff base hit. What did Coach Stankiewicz do? Sack bunt. Does he do it here with McDonald at the plate?
It'd be interesting to see what he does there because Mark Mumper's in the nine hole underneath him. You don't want to have two outs necessarily, but Mumper's a guy that can get you a clutch base hit, and he's in the lineup for a reason. So maybe Jared McDonald bunts him over, and that's what he's going to do.
Now to third, Ping. Might have had a play at second, but he takes a safe out over to first. So now for the second consecutive inning, leadoff single and a sack bunt. Runner at second with one out here in the bottom of the second. 1-0 GCU, and we'll bring a Mumper up to the plate. Well, good to see both Sines and McDonald getting that bunt down nicely to the third baseman, making him make the throw across and allowing the runner to get to second easily.
Yeah, and GCU scored when they've gotten the first guy on base with no outs in the inning, and a very high percentage if you can score with a base runner with no outs in the inning, somewhere around 65-67%, Michael. So GCU able to put a runner in scoring position here for Mumper, and they were able to do that with Bull to lead things off in the first.
Mumper hitting .167 on the year, no homers, no RBI, had a walk in the ball game yesterday. Pitched down low and in the dirt, so he's ahead in the count. One ball, no strikes. Mumper, a guy who they would love to see him flourish and take over that shortstop role so they could put Bull at second, maybe a bit more comfortable position for Bull. We've seen Bull play short pretty well this year, but seems like a very good second baseman. Mumper has all that potential. They're just kind of waiting for him to show him what he's gotten. You know, if Mark could do that, he'd be at that shortstop spot for about the next 3 years.
Yeah, GCU really needs to solidify that middle infield. They already have Bull in it, so half of it's completed. And if they can get Mumper to be that everyday starter at shortstop, they wouldn't really have any questions about their infield
right.
the rest of the way, and they don't even have to worry about how they're going to change up the defense in the outfield and then who plays DH.
Yeah, Mumper, all kind of potential, great teammate. Everybody loves him. Just giving him a chance here. Only hit a .154 last year, but, you know, only got 26 at-bats and only got into 19 games last year. The 2-0 in the air to right, fouled off. Two ball, one strike to count to Mark Mumper. Top of the order, and Austin Bull on deck. Lopes lead at 1-0 here in the bottom of the second inning. Bait out there in right field. Looks a little deep out there and shaded more towards center. So a bit of a gap down that line. Ooh, spin for a pickoff. Had he thrown that, they might have caught him because Kona was going the wrong way, and then he dove a bit too early. But Granoff, for some reason, didn't make the throw. Looked like the second baseman, Perry, was there to take the throw. Just chose not to do it.
Kona bluffed on a straight steal earlier in the at-bat here.
Up high, 3-1. While that breaking pitch that it looked so good at times throughout the first inning. That one just hanging out off of the plate, and the Lopes doing well not to chase it.
Yeah, first breaking ball, first pitch breaking ball that Granoff has missed, had missed to a right-handed batter, and now he's missed another breaking ball here to Mumper.
3-1 in the dirt, and he walked him. Well, that's a great walk for Mumper because he didn't really get any pitches he could do anything with, so he took him, fouled one off, and now you got runners at first and second, and your best hitter coming up in Austin Bull.
This is a very, very good opportunity and a very good spot for GCU here with Bull in the top of the lineup due up and runners on first and second. And this is the inning with runners on first and second, only one out in the top of your lineup. This is where GCU really needs to put a crooked number up.
Yeah, Bull had that base hit single, came around to score the only run of the ball game in the first here. Austin inning 378 on the season. No homers. Three RBI, but he scored 12 runs from the leadoff spot. Switch hitter from the right side once again. Goes after the first pitch, and this might be two. Bobbled a bit, second for one, back to first. And the twin killing, and exactly the opposite of what we were looking for. Close play down there at first base. It looked like Giratano might have bobbled the ball just a bit, but it was hit hard enough they were able to turn two and get out of the inning. So once again, Lopes have a couple of guys on, one man in scoring position, and can't get the job done. So no runs on one hit, there were no errors, and one man left on base. He has a close play down there first, but the first base umpire, Rob McKinley, said they got him. That is the inning. We've completed 2-1-0, GCU with the lead.
Earning your RN to BSN degree online doesn't have to be without the college experience. Finding your purpose takes support from those around you. GCU's leadership offers over 3 decades of experience delivering our accredited RN to BSN program 100% online. Graduate in as few as 16 months, learning from full-time practicing nurse faculty in small classes. Integrate your education with your faith and Christian worldview.
Find your purpose online at Grand Canyon University. Private, Christian, affordable. Visit gcu.edu.
Michael Potter, Fletcher Like here with you. Beautiful day at Brazel as we are underway in game three of this three-game set between the Lopes and the Dons. The Dons took the first two. Lopes trying to salvage one here, up 1-0 as we go to the third. Lopes about hit the Dons 3-1, but you know, Fletcher, already three left on base for GCU.
Yeah, GCU unable to score a bunch of runs when they have opportunities with less than two outs in the inning with runners in scoring position, and GCU's really going to need to capitalize on these opportunities if they want to be successful the rest of the season.
Bottom third of the order for the Dons, Helland Bate and Villa Roman to face Jake Repovich, and Rep has pitched very well here early on. First pitch fastball, strike once again, and so a couple of lefties, but Granoff really working that breaking pitch first, whereas Rep liking to spot that fastball in or away. Really moving around good. Looks like he's got great command over that fastball.
Yeah,
0-1.
Rich Dorman's really come in and changed the way that these starting pitches for GCU and the whole entire pitching staff pitches. Rather than keeping everything down in the zone, everything's been in and out, up and down, changing eye levels, changing where the ball is coming across the plate, and it really can mess with the batter's eye level and viewpoint of where the ball is because they never know where it's going to come from.
0-2 count to Helland, 231 batting average, no homers, 3 RBIs, getting his first start of this series, his fourth start of the year. Repovich has retired the leadoff man the last two innings, and he's working to face the minimum. He did give up a base hit to Puskarich in the first, but then he promptly picked Ross off first base to end that inning. Up high, wouldn't chase it, a little too high. 1-2 the count to Helland. Well, Repovich been moved around a bit this year, but initially it looked like it was going to be Deegan Hart, the Friday guy, Jake Wong, the Saturday guy, or reverse that. Jake Wong, the Friday guy, Deegan Hart, the Saturday guy, Repovich maybe the Sunday guy, but swing and a miss in the dirt. Gets away from Jared McDonald. He fires down to first, and so first strike of the ball game for Jake Repovich. That'll bring up Brady Bate. It's good to see Repovich. Hart has struggled early on, obviously, and Wong has been fantastic. And Rep has been kind of somewhere in the middle, but more toward Wong than how Hart's been pitching. It'll be interesting to see how this, you know, staff of three shakes out, especially as they go on the road and have some midweek matchups. First pitch misses to Brady Bate. Bate getting the start in this one, had been coming in as a defensive replacement the first two games. Ooh, big swing and a miss, 1-1. Bate hitting 342 on the year, 1 homer, 7 RBI. He's made the most of it. He does have, 11 starts prior to this one, so this is his 12th start of the year. Down low, 2-1. Bate, a junior out of Spanish Fork, Utah, played at Mesa Community College. And this is, we talked about it in the pregame with Andy Stankiewicz, which we put that interview up, and you can access it off of Twitter at GCU Baseball. Fouled back, count goes to 2-2. But really a difference here, a very underclassman-rich team for GCU and a very upperclassman-rich team for the Dons. Pretty much everybody in upperclassmen playing significant innings for the Dons, except for Villaroman, the man on deck. For the Lopes, pretty much freshmen and sophomores. The 2-2 in the dirt. They hit him, got him on the foot. So second base runner of the ball game aboard.
Tyler Villaroman.
That'll bring in Villaroman, the aforementioned freshman on this squad. Villaroman hitting 273, no homers, 4 RBI, but a speedster, 9-for-9 on the base paths and steals, and had 3 steals in the first ball game on Friday here at Brazel.
I was about to say, you don't want to get him on base and let him start showing off his legs, because then you get into a situation where you don't want to be in when guys start running on the base paths.
Well, Bate over there, they got to be careful with him. He's 4-for-4 in stolen bases. So this is a squad that does like to run. You look at that, and they like to have that speed at 8-9 and then up at 1-2. Not a lot of speed in the middle of the lineup, but they really like it at the top of the order and the bottom of the order.
Yeah, coming into the series, they had stolen 23 bases in just 13 games, so GCU really need to keep them off the base paths if they want to stop stolen bases.
Yeah, he got him. Boy, that's a nice play. That is harder than it looks down there. We'll see if we get a replay in that one. Villaroman thought he beat it out, but boy, definitely button for a base hit with one out. It does move the runner up to second. Boy, Repovich, a quick play. Ooh, Villaroman might have an argument there.
That was close. And that's the speed that he just flashed there. And you don't want him on base because he can show that speed all the way around the bases, not just from home to first.
So Lopes might have got a break on that call. It looked very close, but it looked like he might have just beat it by a hair. See if they can take advantage of that GCU and get out of this inning. Sinatra ground out to short, first time up. Takes that one up high. One ball, no strikes. Yeah, what'd you say? They came in with 23 steals, so already, you know, six steals in this series. And they've also used their speed in other ways, really pushing the action on ground balls. The Lopes have booted a few around in the infield. And they're not afraid to take that extra base.
Very aggressive on the base paths. And Jisoo started throwing the ball around the yard, committing a bunch of errors during the series, and kind of looked a little bit like a younger Little League team, scared the guys were going to start stealing bases on when a ball's in play. And Jisoo just got to relax and let the ball come to them and just make the smart play, get an out. Don't worry about the guy going from second to third, bluffing on a play at home. Just get the out at first base.
Yeah, Andy Stankiewicz had the squad out here taking some just real basic rudimentary infield practice. Strike on the outside corner, one ball, two strikes to Sinatro. Instead of having a full batting practice today, the Dons, coming in late, seeing the Lopes out there, just basically taking infield practice. Coach Stankiewicz in the pregame said, hey, you know, that's my responsibility. I'm the head coach, but I'm also the defensive guy. I'm the guy that played years in the majors with a 980 fielding percentage, so I don't like to see my guys booting the ball around out there. It's mainly the infield doing it. That one misses outside 2-2.
He's taken over a lot more of the team aspect of the program. Third base coach, so he's taking over the offense, taking over the running game. He's a defensive coach as well, the manager, the head coach. He's really keeping a control of this program here with a very, very young squad as well, as you've talked about.
Two balls, two strikes, two outs. Man on second. Lopes up 1-0. We are in the third. The pitch. Little tapper to short. Mumper's got a hustle. Fields it. Throws on the run. The stretch. They got it. Nice play by Mumper. And Mark getting the job done. Retiring Sinatro for the second time of the day. The ground out. So GCU works around the hit batter, Brady Bate. They strand him out there at second. And in the third, no runs on no hits. There were no errors and one man left on base. We go to the bottom of the third, 1-0 GCU.
Want to work on campus? GCU is hiring student workers for summer 2017. Some jobs may start as soon as this semester. Build your resume and gain real-world experience as a GCU student worker. Find a job on March 29th on the student promenade, or start applying online today at gcu.edu/student employment.
Granoff back on the hill here as we go to the third. And he's really minimized damage as he had a couple of guys on with a run across in the first and got out of it with just one run, and then got the ground ball double play on a 6-4-3, a close play over there at first. But the call went their way. A 6-4-3 double play to end the inning and strand runners once again. So Granoff, I mean, you can look at it both ways. Boy, he's really pitched himself out of jams there. Oh, boy, it's just a few moments away from him and having the wheels fall off, depending on how you look at it. Sines, Evans, and Schwartz do up for GCU. Sines had that sack bunt to move Bull into scoring position. Austin did come around to score, so this will be his second plate appearance, but possibly his first official at-bat of this ball game. And Sines, one of those guys, if Mumper kind of takes over the shortstop role, which puts Bull back at second, because Bull's going to be in one of those spots, second or short, he's going to play, you know, the majority, if not every game this year. Sines, one of those guys who could kind of take over that second base spot if they have to move Bull back to short. Definitely going to be in there. That one's a breaking pitch for a strike. Definitely going to be in there for his bat. You know, Cuba Best has kind of taken the role of the left-handed designated hitter, but Sines is the guy from the right side if you're going to put a right-handed DH up there.
Yeah, it's a position they're going to platoon. They're going to really get platoon the second base position as well.
Little pop, shallow left field. It stayed on the grass or the dirt there, and Giratano makes the grab for the first out.
Ian Evans.
So now Sines officially 0-for-1. That'll bring up Ian Evans. Ian had a nice at-bat, got behind in the count, worked till he got his pitch by fouling him off, and then ripped one into left center field. Brought home the first run of the ball game in Austin Bull. Goes with the fastball that time to start him off. Well, we wondered, and that's in there for a strike, if he might change the way he's attacking these batters second time through the lineup.
Yeah, we wondered if he was going to do that, and he really like to go with breaking balls early in the count, just like there on that 0-1 pitch that Evans was able to foul off, but he's really utilized and pitched well ahead in counts using that breaking ball.
Yeah, and it looks like, you know, with Bull, I believe, he swinging at the first pitch, I believe that was a fastball. He did throw the breaking ball to Sines on the first pitch, but, you know, it was really kind of the first time he'd faced Sines because Sines bunted the first time up. That one misses down low. So he starts a fastball to Evans in the breaking pitch and then throws one to the backstop here underneath the legs of the catcher, Helen. So one ball, two strike count. This is where Evans got his base knocked, fouled a bunch off, and then got a base hit. Came into this game hitting 357 against left-handed pitching. The 1-2. Fastball, tried to paint the outside and missed it, 2-2. Well, GCU coming into this ball game as a team hit 264 against lefties and 287 against righties. Hadn't faced a ton of lefties this year. The 2-2 from Granoff. Ripped to short. Nice play, the spin, the toss for the out. Well, that's the senior out there at shortstop, Nico Giratano, making it look easy. Much harder play than it truly was, but that's a second out of the inning. That'll bring up Garrison Schwartz with two outs and nobody on.
And a little pirouette there really epitomized the play there, really showed off his ability to get that ball deep in the hole, up the middle, make the spin, and the strong, accurate throw over first base. Great play there.
And he made the throw, and then he kind of saw that it was online and just turned his back. Didn't even see the end of the play, like the guy shooting the three, you know, and already turned around running down the other way. Feeling very confident, knows what he's doing out there. Breaking pitch, strike. Gary walked his last time up. And Garrison hitting just a .133 against lefties this year. Like we said, we're early in the season, so not a lot of numbers, so I'm not sure those statistics mean a ton. But they are the same nonetheless. And so a steady diet of breaking balls right here. Gary down the count, no balls and two strikes.
I'd be very surprised if Granoff stays the same game plan the third time through the lineup. Two straight breaking balls from Granoff, two sweeping curveballs here to Garrison Schwartz, lefty.
And he hits him. Boy, was that, was he just trying to throw the fastball inside, or is that maybe a slider that didn't break? It didn't, it looked like a little better pace than his typical breaking pitch. He might have just been trying to go inside and tight. You can see Gary grimacing right there as he heads down to first base, but he keeps hitting alive, and now let's see if Quinn Cotton can make him pay. So Schwartz on for the second time. He walked, and he was hit by a pitch. Two outs here in the third, 1-0 GCU. Cotton flew out to center. He's only at bat in this ballgame. Fastball up high, misses. So now Quinn Cotton is 0-for-5 in this series. Still looking for his first base knock of the series. Tyler Wyatt got the start in left field over Cotton in the ballgame yesterday. Not starting years, said we might actually see him out of the bullpen on the mound, Tyler Wyatt. So they're not giving him the start here. Breaking pitch in there, 1-1. So when Wyatt got the start in left field, now he just needs to get a start behind the plate as catcher in center field and right, and he will have played every position here. He's been a starting pitcher, a relief pitcher, every infield spot except for catcher, and now left field. Actually played pretty well out there. We weren't sure what he'd do out there, but he made a couple nice plays in left. The 1-1. In the dirt, 2-1.
They should change Ty Wyatt's position from infield to utility.
The true definition, right? Yep. Doing everything. Hasn't pitched yet this year, but we may see him. And he might be pressed into action, you know, especially in some of these midweek games. But there might be an opening in that starting rotation for a guy like that who had a really good end of the year. Gary goes, picked off the throw. Did they get him in time? They did. Looked like he was going on the first movement there. Thought he might have figured something out. So Schwartz is caught stealing to end the third. So no runs, no hits, no errors, and nobody left on base. We've completed three, 1-0 GCU with the lead.
Hey Phoenix, it's Thunder Dan Marley, head coach at Grand Canyon University. Coming to GCU was a great move for me. Join Antelope Nation by enrolling as an evening student at our beautiful campus in the heart of Phoenix. Earn your bachelor's, master's, or doctoral degree to take your career to the next level. Engage with industry expert instructors in small classroom settings where you can get the support you need to excel. Scholarships available. See you on campus Dolos.
Find your purpose at Grand Canyon University. Visit gcu.edu/evening.
We go to the fourth inning here. The Lopes lead it. One run, three hits, no errors, three left on. The Dons, no runs, one hit, no errors, and one left on. Jake Repovich getting ready to go. Michael Potter and Fletcher Like here with you. And I'll turn things over to Fletcher for the next couple innings.
Giratano Puskarich and Mirolio do up for the Dons here, looking for some base runners. Jake Repovich really been dealing so far. He's only allowed two base runners and only faced one over the minimum. And Repovich has really been a guy that's, as you said, Michael, towards that Jake Wong side of the starting rotation.
Right.
That one really poor game coming against Wichita State. And that's going to happen when you're playing in 30-degree weather and the wind chill makes it even lower than that. Cold bats, cold arms, but they've come back to warm weather. Jake Repovich and Jake Wong have pitched well, and they're back in sunshine. The bats have come alive in the sunshine, and GC is just needing to finish up that back half of the lineup in the pitching staff and shore up some ball games late in games. They've given away a bunch of games, but Repovich going up against Giratano. Flew out to right in the first inning here against Repovich for the second time through. Looks at a first pitch fastball in the outer part of the plate for strike number one.
Yeah, Giratano, the senior shortstop, really the team leader for these guys, this older upperclassman laden squad, and the coach's kid as well.
Goes from inside, from outside to in there from Jake Repovich, really using and placing pitches all over the strike zone, up in the zone, down in the zone, inside and out. And is ahead in the count, 0-2 here to Giratano, the coach's son for the Dons. The 0-2, swung on and missed. The first strikeout of the inning here for Repovich and the second of the day.
Looked like he went a little high on that one, trying to get him to chase something with the 0-2 count. And Giratano, you know, not normally for him, a pretty good eye, but boy, he chased that one, and no way he was catching up to it for the first out of the inning.
Repovich really likes to go with the pitch up in the zone for his throwaway on the 0-2, and was able to get Giratano, seasoned hitter, to chase that one. And it's the first out of the inning. Brings up Puskarich, who looks at a first pitch on the inside part of the plate that's low in the zone. Repovich all over the place, but he's able to locate pitches well, and that's a pitch right there that isn't a miss. He's doing that on purpose. He's throwing that ball down in the zone on purpose. Ground ball left side. Malice cuts it off and will throw it to first base for out number two.
Well, Malice just ranging a bit to his left there, and that's good to see. Oddly enough, folks, if you're just joining us, it was some little choppers like that that caused the Lopes some trouble. More with guys on and pushing the action, but easy play there for the second out of the inning. And boy, Repovich looking to go 1-2-3 here possibly and get through the fourth, just facing the minimum.
That's how Puskarich reached in the first inning, a little tapper that just got underneath the glove of Repovich, but then was picked off at first base on a great move by Repovich. Brings up Mirolio, the DH.
Ooh,
lifts one to
it?
Left. At the track is,
hey, there we go.
Caught and makes the grab with a hand on the wall. Three up, three down. No runs, no hits, no errors. Nobody left on base for the Dons. We head to the bottom half of the fourth here on GCU TV. Check out companies on campus this week in the Student Union. Network with different companies, learn about jobs and internships, and maybe even land a job. For more information, contact Career Services at gcu.edu. or follow them on Facebook for future opportunities at facebook.com/GCU Career Services.
You know, Fletcher, I don't know. I've never been a pitcher. Well, I did pitch once in Little League and gave up a grand slam. I don't remember it yet that well, that fondly. But, man, that made me nervous on that swing. I don't know how Repovich stayed so steely as he walked off. The warning track power there just got under it, but that looked very reminiscent of the home run that Mirolio hit to basically the game-winning home run last night.
Yeah, got a lull, all that ball right there. Just not enough to get it over the wall. Tall wall. It would have been extra bases off the top of the wall
right
there with the taller wall, but off the bat, that one looked gone, and it was able to stay in the yard, and Repovich is probably breathing a sigh of relief right now in the dugout, waiting for his next opportunity against the bottom half of the frame. But Cotton Malice and Quiggle do up for GCU. Quiggle reaching in the second on a single, and Cotton and Malice both flying out to the outfield in the first.
There's a little bit of a breeze out there. It's only about 6 or 7 miles an hour. I think it might have gusted up to about 10 or 11 there. Got a little help on that one. The breeze blowing in a little bit. The flag's going toward the right field foul line.
The breeze blows in here at Brazel. The breeze blows out at the GCU softball stadium. So
that's true.
A lot of softballs leave the yard at the softball stadium, especially when the gusts get up there to about 25, 30 miles an hour, and those softballs really get out of there in a hurry off some of those GCU softball bats. They really got to get a hold of them here at Brazel as Cotton lifts one down the right field line out of play. He's got an 0-2 count now against Granoff. Granoff really pitching well early in counts, but has missed a couple times, and GCU has been able to jump on him and put him in the gaps.
Cotton, one of those great freshmen they got. Really, really excited about Cuba Best, Quinn Cotton, and Kona Quiggle, and getting to play more here, you know, due to those injuries you mentioned earlier. Hasn't really shown what he can do offensively, but they expect great things out of this guy.
Yeah, Cotton's a guy that Stankiewicz asked if he'd be willing to play summer collegiate baseball after his senior year of high school, getting prepared for the season this year, and he jumped all over the opportunity. Did well for his summer league team and is doing good things here for GCU.
There we go.
Laced in the right field hole between first and second, and that's a leadoff single here for GCU in the fourth, and puts a runner on base to lead things off for the third time in four innings.
And Quinn, first base hit of the series. There we go. Well, you know, with baseball especially, too, you just got to get some ABs. And fortunately, I mean, that's the silver lining on some of these injuries. You're going to get some ABs for these freshmen.
Get some ABs and good things will happen. Garrison Schwartz, one of those guys, very slow start. But get him some ABs, eventually things will start turning around. Zach Malice is a guy that is hitting very well so far, hitting .282 coming into the game. 11 total hits and two doubles. Looking for his first hit today. Flew out to right in the first when six GCU batters went to the plate against Granoff, only able to push one a run across.
Malice, one of those guys picked on the all-WAC team preseason selections. Of course, Gary, the player of the year, Malice, was recognized. First team at-large selection. Had a really nice year last year. Got into a lot of games for GCU. Started 36, played in 44, hit over 300.
Really took over that first base position as well as a freshman. GCU really didn't know who was going to be that first baseman coming in. They kind of had to play around with it at the beginning of the season. Finally, Malice kind of took over the job, and then they said, hey, we need you to flip over to third base. We don't have a third baseman this year. That was another position they platooned last year, was third base. And Malice is kind of taking that over, and now Stankiewicz doesn't have to worry about it.
Yeah, we saw them make that switch up at Northern Colorado where they put signs, wanted to keep that bat in the line. It put him over at first, and they put Zach at third. I think they only did it one or two games up there and didn't really do it much the rest of the year, but, boy, it was a great-looking lineup, really changed things for them. So they've gone with it here this year.
The 2-1 breaking ball upstairs again. John Flanagan really not giving either pitcher and Granoff or Repovich the top of the zone so far. Both pitchers have been able to hit the same spot, but Flanagan's not budging on his strike zone.
Yeah, that breaking pitch up high, he doesn't like to give that at all.
Quick pick over to first base. Gets away from Puskarich, and Cotton's in there safely.
Well, it's just a 1-0 ball game. I mean, you got your leadoff man aboard. You're not asking Malice to bunt as you have been the last two times you had the leadoff man aboard. So, you know, Quinn's got some good speed. Do you try to do something here on a 3-1 count or just play it out?
Hit and run could be in order here for GCU, and that's maybe why Granoff went over to first. The 3-1 pitch, no hit and run applied, lifted to center, and this one's going to be easy for Villaroman.
Well, that ball, it was pushed back in toward the infield as well. I mean, he got well under it, but you could see Villaroman had to go a little bit further than he might have thought initially. So they don't put anything on there. Not surprised. Coach Stink was, you know, doesn't hit and run near as much as you just either straight steal or sacrifice bunt. So not real surprised they didn't put something on there, but now they got one out here, and Quiggle's got to get the job done.
singled back in the second and then was stranded at second base after sacrifice bunt by Jared McDonald, who's on deck. And Kona Quiggle put one through the left side. We're on our first now, and a ball from the left side would be quality for GCU. Ground ball left side, double play opportunity. The slide from Cotton might have put Perry off balance just enough to make his throw errant at first base. So it's just going to go down as a fielder's choice there on the double play. 6-4 put out at second. And Quiggle is safe at first base on that fielder's choice.
Yeah, that was interesting because there's a new rule there in college, and they strictly enforce it. When you slide into second, you can't go past the bag, and you got to slide directly into second. We had a couple plays last year where the guy was off maybe less than a foot, and they called them out. That time, Quinn, man, he went in there hard, right at the bag, and it looked like Perry didn't do a great job of getting out of the way and took the brunt of that one. So good no call as far as the slide. It was perfectly legal, but they get the lead guy.
It was going to be a tough double play either way with the ball ranging to Giratano's right, deep in that 5.5 hole, and Quiggle was able to leg it out. That brings up Jared McDonald, who sacrificed bunted Quiggle over in the second. Most likely not going to bunt him over here with two outs in the inning. Looks at a pitch upstairs, just checks his swing in time. Mark Bumper on deck, walked back in the second as well, then was part of that double play by Austin Bull to end things in the second inning.
McDonald was one of my favorite players down the stretch last year. Played in 25 games, got 21 hits and 19 RBI. He was the RBI machine down the stretch. Seemed like every time he came up, there was somebody on and he got a base hit. And there for a strike, wow.
Low in the zone there, Flanagan giving the strike there to Granoff. Now he's ahead in the count here to McDonald. McDonald, one of those guys that stepped up to the plate and was able to produce late in the season for GCU when they needed somebody to step into that catcher position and give them offense. They didn't have any offense from the catcher position until Jared McDonald took it over, and really took it over by storm out of nowhere, too.
Yeah, they had a Steerstore for the transfer, hit under 100. Griffin Barnes, you know, didn't get a ton of at-bats, but didn't produce, hit under 200. And then you got Jared McDonald in 362, but only 58 at-bats. You come in here thinking, well, maybe he's a front-runner, but you got McDonald, you got Barnes, and you got Josh Meyer back, and it seems like this year, Barnes has been the guy who's put in the work and kind of produced offensively and defensively, so he got the first two starts in this series.
Very surprised to see Jared McDonald not the everyday starter to begin the season. Ground ball left side. This one's going to get through past the dive of Giratano. Runners on first and second here with two outs. And that'll bring up Mark Mumper.
You know, this is great for Coach Stankiewicz. Part of the problem at times is you can get a little complacent when you look behind you and there's nobody pushing you for playing time, you know, and we see that with guys. The guys who are juniors and seniors, they don't need somebody pushing them, but some freshmen and sophomore, when you look around and say, hey, who are you going to put in for me, coach, you can get a little complacent. So the better McDonald plays, I think the better you'll see Barnes play as well.
Competition produces quality play, and it's something that Stankiewicz will – and every coach will love to have.
Yep.
It's a tough decision, but you'd rather have a tough decision than no decision.
Right.
And now there's runners on first and second for Mark Mumper. The ball gets away from the catcher, Helland. And now there's two runners in scoring position here for Mark Mumper with two outs in the inning.
Well, a wild pitch moves him up. So now Mumper's got a chance. Need that two-out base knock, though. So many games won and lost on two-out base hits. Mumper's got a shot here. Looking for his first base hit of the series. He was, man, 0-for-3, but did have a walk in the last at-bat last night and in his first at-bat here. So he's been on base a couple times, but looking for that base hit here.
That'll bring a mound visit here for the Dons. Mark Mumper, one hit total in the season, hitting 167. Just his third start of the season as well. Has two walks now, three total strikeouts. A walk would load the bases to bring up the top of the lineup, but that really doesn't help GCU that much, even though it brings up the top of the lineup. You'd rather have Mumper put the ball in play here and force the Dons to make a play as well. Make Granoff pitch to you here with a 1-0 count.
Heiserman had his say heading back. Yeah, you saw a bull chatting with Mumper a little bit. Boy, if you're going to listen to one guy on the team about how to hit, he'd be the guy to listen to.
Absolutely. Leading the team so far with a .364 batting average. And coming alongside his fellow sophomore, telling him, hey, settle down. You got two outs, but you've got two guys in scoring position. Just put the ball in play and good things will happen. The pitch from Granoff, breaking ball, laced up the middle, and that's going to score one at least. The round there from Jared McDonald's, and it's a 3-0 ball game after a single up the middle by the number 9 batter, Mark Mumper.
Way to go, Mumper. Boy, I wouldn't be surprised if Bull didn't tell him, hey, look for that breaking pitch. And we've seen that breaking pitch trouble at times to the lefties, but as you mentioned before, when you throw that a little high to a righty, lefties don't like that breaking pitch up high necessarily. You throw that to a righty, and his eyes just light up as big as saucers, and Mumper did the trick on that one, just laced it up the middle for a couple of RBI. And here we go, 3-0 GCU now.
Big hanging curveball there from Grana, finally caught up to him. GCU seeing him for the second and third time now as Austin Bull steps in for his third at-bat against Granoff. And this time, the first pitch to Austin Bull is not a breaking ball, it's a fastball, and it misses up and away.
Already some action down there in the bullpen for the Dons. Looks like number 35, Joey Steele, warming up. So they might have a short leash trying to sweep this series.
And it's 2-0 count now for Austin Bull after that pitch misses inside. And Granoff's gone away from his breaking ball that's been successful all day long after Mumper jumped all over it. And that fastball really hasn't been able to be controlled by Granoff so far. He's kind of lost command of that so far through the game. But that breaking ball, he's been able to put where he wants it.
Mumper just 5 RBI last year. So he had 2 here on that one swing of the bat.
3 straight balls here from Granoff. And not the best body expressions and facial expressions out on the mound right now behind 3-0 here to Bull.
Yeah, he's struggling a little bit here trying to find that zone. Well, it was his breaking pitch that was doing the trick, but it does look like he's been leaving that up. Like I mentioned, the lefties don't like it up too much, but boy, the righties do.
That fastball clips the outer part of the plate for strike number 1, so it's 3-1 now to Austin Bull. Runner at first is Mark Mumper, 2 RBI single up the middle on a breaking ball from Granoff. Finally missed one.
This might be an interesting play here if they put anything on with Mumper and Bull.
The 3-1, right over the middle of the plate there for Bull. Decided not to swing on it, and now it's full here with 2 outs in the inning.
It almost looked like he was thinking curveball right there because he didn't even offer it that, and that was just right down the pipe.
All fastballs from Granoff so far on this at-bat to Bull. No curveballs we've seen yet going away from what seemed like his best pitch so far in the afternoon. Bigger lead for Bull, takes off.
Hot shot, but he's got it.
And it's the third out of the inning. But GCU sends 6 to the plate, puts 2 runs across, and has a 3-0 ball game lead here. Heading to the 5th here, GCU pushes a couple of runs across here on GCU TV. GCU 3, USF
0. I'm Dominique. I'm a student here at Grand Canyon University studying hospitality management. My hospitality courses here are giving me a high quality education from professors that I know have been successful. Being able to work while I'm in school has enriched my college experience. I feel like I know where I'm going and what I want to do. When they say find your purpose, they mean it.
Find your purpose at Grand Canyon University. Private, Christian, affordable. Visit gcu.edu.
2 runs, 3 hits, no errors, 1 left on base for GCU there in the 4th. We head to the 5th. Perry, Ping, and Helen do up for the Dons. Neither of them have reached base so far today, and Repovich going out for his second appearance against those 3. And the middle half of the lineup for the Dons hasn't been able to produce so far today, but neither has the rest of the lineup for the Dons. Repovich dealing so far through 4 full innings, only giving up 1 hit to the Dons, who've taken the first 2 games. Repovich is doing as much as he can to put GCU in the driver's seat and try to salvage a ball game here against the Dons before the next series.
Yeah, Repovich, that one base hit back in the first inning. He did hit a batter in the third, but he's just been mowing down the Dons so far, really commanding that fastball on the first pitch, just moving it all over the place, and Dons have been able to figure him out. Maroglio almost did. It went to the warning track, the base of the wall, but not quite.
First pitch to Perry is called strike, and Repovich really has kept these Dons batters off balance. Very unpredictable where the ball location is going to be, what his pitch selection is going to be as well. Great decision making by Dorman. Ground ball left side right at Mumper. He'll throw over to first base for the first out of the inning.
Well, you can almost see defensively even Mumper getting a lot more confidence. In the ball game yesterday, he just looked a little tentative out there at short. And, you know, now he's had a couple walks. He got that base hit to drive in some runs. He made a couple plays defensively. And, boy, he could really, if he gets four, five, six starts in a row and plays like this, just, you know, very confident out there. We mentioned, boy, he could take that over. And you look at your lineup now, Malice at third, Mumper at short, Bull at second, and Evans at first. It's pretty good infield.
Definitely a very good infield, and Mumper's starting to play with a little bit of swagger there. Out at shortstop after that two RBI single lifted to center field. Quigo's got a play on it. Long run, though. Ball hanging up in the air, and that's out number two.
So quickly, two up and two down, and just like you said, just faced one over the minimum so far for Repovich. We talked to Coach Stankiewicz prior to the game and said, what do you want out of Rep? He said, six or seven good innings. Well, the way he's throwing here, you know, knock on wood, he could even go further than that.
Wouldn't be surprised if he does as well, because GCU really needs to save that bullpen. The bullpen's given up runs late in games, and if Repovich can continue to do what he's doing, why not leave him out there unless his pitch counts gets really, really up there? But so far, so good for Repovich and his pitch count as well.
Well, the big key for Rep is he's, I don't have the exact stats, but it seems like about 90% of the time he's getting that first pitch fastball over for a strike.
Swing and a miss there from Helland, switching catcher. And Repovich is ahead in the count, 0-2 early here to Helland. And there's two outs in the inning, and Helland needs to do something. Struck out in the third, and is going to need to battle off some pitches here from Repovich if he's going to make it just one. Lifted to center field, long run for Quiggle. It's going to fall in between the second baseman, Bull, and Quiggle. Bull's on the ground there after that collision. And it's a single for Helland here with two outs.
Well, that was in no man's land. He did not hit that ball well, but gets the base hit to extend the inning, but that would just fell where nobody could get to it.
Off the bat, it looked like Quiggle was going to have a play on it, and then it started to fall, and Quiggle was still running. And then Bull was running out for it as well, and then the ball just fell. So definitely no man's land. Unfortunate there for Repovich. He's just given up his second hit of the day. Just two batters over the minimum so far here to Brady Bate. He's hit by a pitch and then moved over second base on a ground ball. Swings to the first pitch he sees. And Repovich has been blowing by the Dons with a first pitch fastball.
I like that aggressiveness by Bate, because if you got a guy who you've been watching him and through, you know, the entire first four and two-thirds innings, he's been throwing a first pitch strike, you might as well go up there and swing at the first pitch, because it's probably going to be a strike.
Throw over to first, not in time. Repovich has picked off a runner. That was Puskarich at first base. And Repovich got through the first with just seeing the minimum, even though he technically threw to four different batters. The 0-1, swung on and missed again. So Repovich ahead in the count early here to Bate, the right fielder for the Dons, transferred from Mesa Community College, originally out of Spanish Fork, Utah. Repovich gets a sign from McDonald. Runner first, we'll look over, and then come home. Delivery, and that's fouled out of play.
You know, pretty good gap there in left center field. More than likely tells you they're going to try to work Bate away after that first pitch fastball on the inside part of the plate. And he was a little late on that one.
Repovich's velocity has really shown here today against the Dons, just blowing past the Dons batters. The Dons really haven't been able to stay in front of it except for that ball that Murillo hit deep to left. Pitch outside, got it. Strikeout number three on the day for Repovich, and he puts Bate down for the first time today and ends the fifth, and we head to the bottom of the fifth with no runs, one hit, no errors, and one left on base for the Dons after that backwards K by Repovich to Bate. GCU still holding on to that 3-0 lead here against the Dons, looking to salvage a win in the third game of the series here on GCU TV.
Well, Bate had been very, very aggressive and at the first couple of strikes. That one, I think he thought that Repovich was maybe going to waste one, and Repovich did put it right over the outside corner and was able to get the strikeout call.
Award-winning and chart-topping artists take the stage on March 22nd for the 9th Annual Rock and Worship Roadshow at GCU Arena. Experience Christian music's most uplifting and entertaining concert series for the whole family. General admission tickets are just $10. Get your tickets now at gcuarena.com.
Kranoff back out there. Wasn't sure. They've got guys warming in the pen. Probably have a pretty short leash. I thought they might even pull him and have somebody else start because the Lopes have quite a few righties and switch hitters in this lineup today. Thought they might go to the right-hander, but they're going to give Kranoff another crack at it here in the fifth inning. I mean, you don't love to go to your bullpen in the fifth inning, but you also have a chance to sweep a series here on the road. So I'm sure they won't give him a super long leash.
Definitely not going to be a super long leash with Sines, Evans, and Schwartz two up. Three GCU hitters that can really put a hurt on you if you make any mistakes over the plate. Specifically, Ian Evans and Garrison Schwartz, even though Garrison Schwartz really hasn't gotten started, but yeah, you don't want him to get started if you're the Dons.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you got a couple of right-handed. That's why I kind of thought they might go to the righty out there warming up with Sines and Evans coming up. And then after Schwartz, you got Cotton, but we'll give Granoff another shot here and see how he does.
The first pitch to Sines from Kranoff, starting things off with another breaking ball. He was successful when he did that earlier in the game. Went away from it after that single up the middle by Mark Mumper. And he went away from it after that at bat toss and bowl. Was able to get out of that inning on a ground ball at second base. Sines lifts one to left field. This one is gone. A solo shot by Greg Sines.
Well, Sines turned on that one. Hung up there for him. We talked about it. Those righties, man, when you see a breaking pitch, it's about belt high. The eyes light up, the dollar signs go off, and you just swing out of your shoes. Sines does it there and gives the Lopes that 4-0 lead. Boy, what a crush job by Greg Sines.
Kranoff, too predictable, and Sines makes him pay there. And that might be it for Kranoff. Very short leash as Nino Giarratano comes out to the mound, brings his entire infield in, and that's going to be a pitching change here. Granoff's day is done, giving up four runs, all of them earned. And GCU's got a 4-0 lead here in the fifth and no outs.
Well, you know, Kranoff looked pretty good, even though he gave up a run in the first. Got that double play in the second, and we mentioned, you know, he's pretty good. He's kind of around it, but, you know, if you're the Dons, you can say, man, he's not even pitching that great, and he's got him out. And, you know, if he rights himself, he's good. But if you're the Lopes, you say, man, the wheels are going to fall off at some point because this guy's missing his spots. And that's why I thought that Giarratano might send somebody else out to start this inning because he just – Giarratano, you know, giving him one more chance. But it just didn't look like Kranoff could spot that curveball, which was by far his best pitch. And when you can't do that and you're limited to throwing a fastball that's not so great or a curveball that's hanging, bad things happen.
Yeah, definitely bad things going to happen, especially when you can't terminate with a curveball or a fastball. No strikeouts for Kranoff. He exits after throwing four complete innings, technically appearing in the fifth, four earned runs on seven hits, two walks, no strikeouts, and no one hit by pitch, and he ends his day in line for the loss right now unless his team can give him a no decision and come back from the game. Dons have been able to do that so far. Repovich and GCU's bullpen will try to make sure that does not happen for the third time in a row.
Joey Steele, we saw him warming up, the 6'2 righty, 195-pounder, sophomore out of San Marino, California. And Steele will come in in relief, essentially starting this bottom of the fifth inning, but down 4-0. And if you're Joey Steele, the whole point is, hey, come in here and don't let him get any more. Keep it a four-run ball game. We know we can throw a big crooked number on the board. We threw a five spot and a six spot yesterday. We know we can do it. Just keep him close. And you know, Steele, this will be his sixth appearance, thrown six innings, 6.0 ERA, six hits, four runs, all four earned, walked one, struck out five. So big task for him. The good news is he gets to start off with the righty Evans, but he starts off with the heart of the order for GCU.
A tough chance and tough opportunity and duty here for the freshman to come in against the 3-4-5 batters with no outs in the inning, and knowing that Ian Evans, the team leader for GCU and RBIs, is due up. It's going to be a tough task for Steele here. The first pitch he sees, fastball. Evans wanted that one, swinging out of his shoes there, but misses and can't keep up with that fastball.
Love that approach by Evans. The reliever's coming in. You know he wants to get something across the plate. Just go for it. Like you said, swing out of your shoes and see if you can make contact. Now you settle down a little bit and just try to have an at-bat.
Big sweeping off-speed pitch there. And that one's outside for ball number one. So it's a 1-1 count now for Evans. GCU's got a 4-0 lead here against the Dons. And GCU's finally been able to put together scoreless innings defensively and from their pitching staff. Rubovich pitching very well, going a full five innings so far. Don't be surprised if he lasts more than six or seven.
Evans has really come in from Gateway, the JUCO kid, played in the JUCO D2 World Series last year, came in and really solidified the heart of that order in that right side of the infield for the Lopes. He fouls that one back.
Big pickup for GCU and Annie Stankwitz at first base specifically. Otherwise, you have to try Cuba Best over there at first base a little bit, maybe Greg Sines, but then that changes up your middle infield with only Ty Wyatt and Mark Mumper. Austin Bull's an everyday kind of guy. You can put him either at second or short, but Ian Evans has solidified that corner spot with Zach Malik moving over to the hot corner and really made Andy Stankiewicz have to worry about less in his infield.
Yeah, and it gives a little bit of upperclassman leadership as the junior. You can see what Coach Stankiewicz is trying to do recruitment-wise. Getting some bigger kids. Is that one going to find itself out of play? But getting some bigger kids with some pop that can scare you a bit in that heart of the lineup. For so many years, a lot of the guys were similar to Coach Stankiewicz, the slider build and, you know, would kind of hit and run, bunt, steal, move the ball around. But now you got guys like Evans, you got Quinn Cotton, you got Kona Quigo, you got Cuba Best. You're recruiting some bigger kids who can really thump the ball.
Trying to push for a postseason bid next year, their first year of eligibility coming in that 2017-18 season. And the WAC, a conference GCU knows they can win. They won it in 2015, the second year in being in the conference. And if GCU can get everybody healthy next year and not have a bunch of holes to fill in the lineup with guys getting drafted, if they do, then GCU's got an opportunity to go to the postseason. Ian Evans strikes out there, bringing up Garrison Schwartz, but GCU's got a good opportunity next year to make the playoffs and get in that field of 64 and hopefully not have to travel very far in regional.
Yeah, you always got to wonder who's coming back from the sense of, you know, juniors are draft eligible. Gary's going to get a look. Obviously, Evans will get a little bit of a look. Some of your pitchers might get a little bit of a look, but you feel pretty comfortable outside of those two guys. You're going to have your entire squad back, and, you know, maybe a couple of those guys come back too.
That would be the hope. See if they can do anything in postseason and get a little Cinderella story like Coastal Carolina. San Francisco going to Coastal Carolina, dropping both of those ball games to the defending national champions. They were my team to win it. I didn't choose them to win it, but I wanted them to win it once they got there.
Not a lot of people chose them to win it. You know, it's cool because it's a Cinderella story in the sense of, you know, they're a smaller school, first time there, that type of thing. But, boy, they had played so well throughout the year. They didn't catch a ton of people by surprise with how well they played. They caught everybody by surprise with the fact that they won it.
They are a team that consistently puts up good numbers, 30-plus win seasons.
Yep.
They win their conference consistently. They're kind of very similar to University of Louisiana, Lafayette, the Raging Cajuns, where they're able to win their conference. They usually host a regional, sometimes even a super regional with a top eight ranking and seeding in the postseason. But they finally are able to get things done. Ground ball right side, right at Perry. Throw over to first, out number two. But Coastal Carolina finally put it together and was able to complete the season, finish it off with that series win in the College World Series against Arizona.
Yeah, the Chanticleers, I think another huge key is what the Lopes are trying to build here, too, is, you know, Gary Gilmore, their head coach, been there 20 years, so really built that program. And then they invested some funds into the stadium and the facilities for baseball. I'm not sure how many years ago the Lopes are going to do that here after this season ends, but, we went out there for basketball, played Coastal Carolina in the CIT last year, and I walked by their facilities, just unbelievable. Hitting cages, the facility right behind the softball field, just gorgeous stuff. So all that stuff together, and, yeah, you get yourself a national championship. And you get good players. That always helps.
Ground ball right side,
there
right past the dive of Puskrich, and it's a two-out single for Cotton, his second hit of the day.
Quinn Cotton came into this one, no hits in the series, and now he's got back-to-back sharply hit singles. Now with two outs, they didn't do anything last time. Do you try to steal him? Do you do a little hit and run here? Do you get a little trickery? Or now that there's a righty on the hill, do you let Zach see if he can drive one? You definitely don't want to get a guy thrown out with a big hitter at the plate like we saw the Dons do earlier.
Would love to see a hit and run here with Zach Malice at the plate and Cotton at first base. A big throwing right-hander in Steele. A lot of velocity behind it. And if Malice can get all the baseball, it could leave the yard over to right field. 330, wind blowing from left to right now. It was blowing in earlier, but a good opportunity here for Malice to rope a ball down the line with the right fielder bait shaded towards center field. Sweeping pitch wraps around the plate, and that's going to be ball number one. So it's a 1-1 count now with two outs to Malice. Two flyouts so far, once in the first and one in the fourth in his third at-bat. First time seeing Steele. He's got a runner at first base, and a good knock here could score Cotton from first if it's in the gap or down the line.
You know, going back to Coastal Carolina, the good thing about a team like that coming, you know, seemingly out of nowhere to win is it gives everybody hope. The bad thing is it gives all the fans, they go, hey, why can't we do that? This is a team that's been good. They were 29-0 in conference play in 2010. It took them another 6 years to get to the College World Series. So it's harder than it seems, and it usually doesn't just come out of nowhere.
Cotton bluffs on a steal attempt. Malice pops one up to right center. It's caught by the center fielder, Villa Roman. And that ends the inning. So three flyouts on the day for Malice. And that ends the inning on one run, two hits, no errors, one left on base for GCU. After five, GCU leads 4-0 here on GCU TV, looking to win game three here against the Dons here on GCU TV.
At Grand Canyon University. Private, Christian, affordable. Visit gcu.edu.
Repovich out back on the mound for the sixth here, and he'll face off against Villa Roman, and then the top of the lineup in Sinatra and Giarratano. And you don't want Villa Roman to get on base. 9-for-9 stolen bases, very speedy. Almost legged out a bunt in the third inning, but was thrown out by Repovich on a good athletic play. And Repovich will see Villa Roman for the second time here in the sixth. GCU leading 4-0 after a solo shot from Greg Sines to lead things off in the inning. And GCU's put themselves in a position where they have an opportunity to win game three and salvage a ball game. But GCU's going to need to continue to put the gas pedal to the floor. Repovich is going to need to continue to hit his spots.
Yeah, Villaroman, you mentioned Fletcher. He's a guy that if you let him on with a walk, a hit bat, or a base hit, it's almost like giving up a double. I mean, he really is that good at stealing bases, so much so that as a freshman, his head coach, his skipper, gives him the green light. He can go whenever he wants to from first base. That's a lot of confidence in a freshman in D1 baseball.
That's not something you hear very often in college baseball at all. Something you would kind of see in high school baseball with a guy that's MVP of his conference, right. MVP, all conference, all state kind of guy. Once you get to college, it's very micromanaged by the coaching staff of when guys go, when they don't go. And then once they get to the pros, then it's all on your own. It's, if you make a mistake on the base paths, that's your fault. Unless it's specifically decided by the coaching staff and upper management of the ball club. But Villaroman has the green light, as you said, Michael, and he's not a guy you want to put on base, and Repovich is in danger of putting him on base here with a 3-0 count.
Well, Rep hasn't put a leadoff man aboard yet in this ball game, and we're in the sixth. We wanted to get him through the sixth or seventh, but if he extends, gets a strike there, but if he extends his pitch count, that'll limit the amount of innings he can go here. Just right around 50 pitches so far, which is a great count.
10 pitches per inning is a great number to be at when you hit the start of the sixth inning. Puts Villaroman on base on a 5-pitch at bat. Brings up the top of the lineup with Sinatra and Giarratano on deck. And Villaroman could be taken off here, but if we see a move like Granoff's over first base, if Villaroman takes off on first movement, Repovich, a lefty, has the ability to throw over to first base if he can see it in time and not balk on the mound, making sure he doesn't cross that 45-degree angle plane that's kind of turned into a 60-degree angle plane, if we're being honest about it.
Well, he's got a good lead over there. We'll see. Top of the order, you don't want to necessarily take the bat out of their hands, but boy, he has a nice lead. Rep staring him down. Little step back sidearm toss. Well, Rep will give him about three or four different looks probably before Villaroman gets comfortable. And who knows, if you're Villaroman, maybe you got the speed, maybe you just go on that first movement there of that front leg.
Don's going to need to do something here, down 4-0. Doesn't go on first movement. Bunt shown. Bunt down the first baseline. It's going to stay fair.
What a great
and
bunt.
It's a bunt single. Mm. Wow.
That thing looked like it was going to spin to that seam, and had it hit that seam, it would have kicked off and easily rolled. But, you know, defensively for the Lopes, that was the correct play. There's no way you're throwing him out with his speed. So you got to just let it go and see what happens. Unfortunately, ball did not bounce the way of GCU, and now you got the heart of the order with Giarratano, Puskarich, and the big catcher, Marolio, coming up.
Giarratano flew out to right in the first, then struck out in the fourth. The double play is in order here for GCU, and if the Lopes can get a ground ball from Repovich here, get Giarratano to ground into a double play, it would kind of nullify the two leadoff runners for the Dons.
Good speed on the base pass for the Dons, and I like that fastball just coming right at him in on the fist.
This is the inning where GCU really needs to buckle down defensively, and Repovich needs to find that grit and find his groove here with a pressure situation, runners on first and second, no outs. And Repovich is an emotional guy out on the mound, and if he can get out of this, don't be surprised if he shows some emotion here with a 4-0 lead. Swung on and missed. That's an 0-2 count there. Big cut, as you said, from Giarratano after he grounded the ball into the dugout down the third baseline. So an 0-2 count here from Repovich to the coach's son, Giarratano.
I'd love to see the splits on him. He looks more comfortable hitting from the left side. We saw him in the first two, and it might just be that the pitching is better, but he even had some good at-bats against Jake and, you know, got six RBIs in this series. But hasn't seemed to swing the bat as well from the right side here.
0-2 today, and an 0-2 count from Repovich. Swung on and missed.
Chased it.
Second strikeout of the day for Giarratano, and Repovich has had his number.
Yeah, that's a huge strikeout there, because now you got that inning-ending first double play in play, and we saw Puskarich, you know, not the fleetest of foot, so he hits a ball on the infield. It should be two for the Lopes if they don't revert back to the earlier couple games. They threw the ball around a bit, six errors coming to this one, but they've played very good defense so far in this one. It's a huge strikeout there.
All of Puskarich's balls he's put in play today have been stayed in the infield, ground ball up the middle, just underneath the glove of Repovich in the first base, and he was picked off in a ground ball to the third baseman back in the fourth. And if he can keep the ball on the infield and on the ground here in the sixth, GCU and Repovich could get out of this with an inning-ending double play, just what Doctor would order.
Well, Maroglio is on deck over there, and that's not the guy you want to bring up with runners on. Had the two-run homer last night and then hit one to the base of the wall his last at bat. So, yeah, you'd love to get a ground ball here, keep that guy leading off the next inning.
Repovich is ahead in the count 0-1 after Puskarich fouled that one off of his foot. Rep comes set, looks back at second base, and will deliver home. Just missing outside, it's 1-1 now. That's a pitch that Flanagan had been giving Repovich all day long. He gave it to Granoff as well. Didn't give it to Repovich this time. Here to Puskarich.
They come back inside on him here after that fastball outside. Nope, stay out.
Missed outside again. It's 2-1 now. Great afternoon here in Phoenix, Arizona. Low to mid-90s, high 80s here in Phoenix, Arizona. I just got off a plane from Illinois, so my body's still kind of in shock right now.
Glad
from
to 32 be here,
degrees.
Huh?
Absolutely glad to be here. It was snowing 2 days ago, and now it's 90 degrees here in Arizona. I was jealous of everybody being able to sit out at the pool this weekend. And I was sticking my hotel room. Runners take off, and the ball is fouled out of play.
That was fortunate because they got a great jump. There's no way there was even probably going to be a throw on that one. But once again, the Dons, with that speed, Villaroman and Sinatra just forcing the action, and that's what speed allows you to do. Had that ball not been fouled off, McDonald would have had a choice. Do I try to make a perfect play? And who knows what happens when you start throwing the ball around. Puskarich probably should have had a take on that one just with the jump they got, but that's hard to do when you see a pitch you want to go after.
It's a 2-2 count now for Repovich. Looks back in second, and then will come home. He's going to flip around and keep everybody where they're at.
That is one thing we've seen with the infield with Mumper in there. He had a difficult time a bit holding runners on, knowing what to do. With the righty up, depending on how they're pitching him, you'd think it would be Bull that might be trying to keep him a little bit closer here, but we'll have to wait and see. If they stay outside, it would be Mumper that would be the guy trying to. Now Bull's going to do it.
Looks back again. Will deliver home. Swung on. Almost takes out a cameraman in the third base dugout.
Did that
and
catch
an athletic
Dewey?
Trainer.
Is he okay?
Dewey, give us a thumbs up if you're all right down there. Almost took out one of the athletic trainers as well. Everybody's all right, it looks
I
like.
I think he's okay. Oh, he puts a hand
gave
up. He says
belief.
He's okay. Yikes. I was scalded in there.
Puts himself in harm's way every day.
Man.
Gets to sit out in the sun. Hopefully, Dewey, you're getting a tan down there.
Boy, that was just scalded down there into the dugout.
Puskarich staying alive here, the 2-2 count. The runners take off again. Ground ball left side. That one stays foul as well.
We got signs down there. Look, we got signs down there standing in front of him. Oh, now he went to chase the ball, but Tommy's going to get it. We got signs. Grabbed a glove, went to protect Dewey. There you go. That's a gamer right there. Signs is like, I'm DH-ing. I'll play defense over here. Oh, now he's done. Golly, Greg, come on. You got one at bat?
Should be standing next to the athletic trainers as well, protecting the two girls down in the dugout.
Yeah, Wyatt's down there by them. He didn't even flinch. That ball went rocketing by him.
Wyatt standing all by himself, yeah. Repovich will step off.
Villaroman, that speed just causes so much trouble. You know, we saw that with the Royals when they won the World Series in 2015, one of the greatest teams ever. I don't know, I'm just a Royals fan. They're not really that great. But the speed really caused trouble for the defense of the Mets. Actually won the game for them, and seen the Dons doing it here.
Lifted to right.
It's not good. That's going to get down.
It's going to be extra bases for Puskarich. Villaroman coming home. And
wow, they held. Sinatra, that's surprising.
Yeah. He's going to put on the brakes at third base, so it's just one run that crosses the plate on the double by Puskarich, but double play is out of order now after that double by Puskarich down the line that Schwartz had no play on.
Well, now you got a decision to make, and I think you still pitch to this guy, but you got Marolia, who had a two-run homer to win the game last night, went to the warning track. You do have a base open, but if you do walk him, then you're looking at putting the tying run on base, so you're probably not going to do that, but you know, you're going to pitch very carefully to this guy because obviously Jake has lost a bit of it here in this inning. So you got to be very careful with this guy because with one swing at the bat, you could be looking at a 4-4 ball game.
Runners on second and third for Marolio. He swings through an off-speed pitch there.
Was that a straight change or a little slider on that? Boy, that was a good-looking pitch.
Marolio was thinking fastball.
As yeah, he was.
Usually comes with a first-pitch fastball, but off balance there, and Marolio was caught with his head towards third base.
Yeah, he's way out in front of that one. Now, see there, McDonald was set up on the outside part of the plate, and that ball came way inside. He had to slide over there. So Jake's struggling. He'd been so effective hitting his spots early and just having trouble hitting his spots here in this inning.
A stressful inning for Repovich after he saw runners on first and second with only one out, and both Sinatra and Villaroman very fast in the base paths. Sinatra being held at third base after the double by Puskarich. Line drive over the top of Mumper. It's going to score one for sure. It's going to score two.
Boy, it's a great play by Cotton to cut that ball off and left. He just flung it back into the infield, but there was nobody there for the cutoff. And Cotton just kind of flung it back in toward the mound. And a couple of sharply hit balls here. And, boy, just like that, right back into this are the Dons. And still no action in the bullpen for the Lopes. It's kind of catching GCU by surprise a bit.
That'll bring Dorman out of the dugout. He'll go chat with Repovich and McDonald. And another three-run inning so far for the Dons in the series. And they've starting to creep up on this 4-0 lead that GCU had to start the sixth, and now it's just a one-run ball game. And a little deja vu action might be settling in for GCU here late in this ball game.
Well, it turned out to be a really good call, and I mentioned on that double by Puskarich, I was a little surprised that they didn't try to score Sinatra, but smart move by Troy Nakamura down there, the third base coach, knowing that he had his big bopper, the number four hitter, Marolio, coming up. Don't run a guy into and out at home plate. You got two guys in scoring position. Count on your big guy to come up, and Marolio did just that, but he scorched that ball on the left. Nice play out there, though, by Cotton to cut it off and, fired the ball back in the infield, but just nobody there for the Lopes. So the run's come across, and now everybody getting a little tighter here for GCU.
It brings up the second baseman, Michael Perry. He grounded into two ground outs, one to third base in the second and one to short in the fifth. So he's been in front of all the pitches from Repovich so far, grounding toward the left side. And if GCU and Repovich can induce another ground ball to the left side, it would be most likely a tailor-made inning-ending double play for Repovich, and get out of it with just three earned runs. Ground ball left side. This is the 6-4-3 double play that we were looking for, and that's what Repovich gets. A double play there to end the inning, but not before the Dons hang a three spot up off of three hits, three runs, three hits, no errors, nobody left on base for the Dons. It's a 4-3 ball game here on GCU TV as we head to the bottom of the sixth inning here on GCU TV.
Yeah, that's the 6-4-3 double play they were looking for. They were just looking for it about two batters earlier. And, like we said, the Dons are an older team. They don't worry about being down four runs. They come back. They get the base hits when they need them. And after Giartano struck out, you thought, hey, maybe this is they're going to fold here, but no such luck. That double by Puskarich, really the key hit in that inning.
You are invited to watch some of the best dunkers and sharpshooters in college basketball at GCU Arena. Witness some of the best college players compete in front of a national audience in the State Farm College Slam Dunk and Three-Point Championships on March 30th.
Well, it is Selection Sunday, and I'm seeing that New Mexico State, the representative out of the Western Athletic Conference, has got a 14 seed and going to play Baylor, the number 3 seed. What region is that? West, Central, East. In the East region, they're going to play Baylor, gets a number three seed.
That surprises me. Baylor getting that three seed. They were surprising to start things off in the season. They went from unranked to first in the country and then lost the first day they were number one in the country. But Kansas really taking the Big 12 by storm in the regular season. And then, Iowa State winning the Big 12 for the third time in 4 years in the Big 12 championship.
Yeah, Kansas getting beat by TCU in that first or second round of that tournament. But, yeah, New Mexico State, I mean, that's, you would think Baylor's, you know, they're the better team, obviously, but if Baylor doesn't play well, that's a game that they can hang around in. I think. Nobody else up here thinks that. But
we're GCU fans. We don't pick New Mexico State to beat Baylor. Ground ball right side right at the first baseman. Puskarich steps in the back just in time.
Yeah, nice play.
To record the out on Kona Quiggle. Jared McDonald and Mark Mumper due up here for the rest of the inning.
You said we're GCU fans, so you never root for New Mexico State. Did you root for them last night against Bakersfield, or did you just not root for anybody?
I was at a men's volleyball game in Illinois, so I was not.
But would you have rooted for them against Bakersfield, or would you just been like, I don't know?
I would be indifferent.
You'd be indifferent?
Mm-hmm.
Really? Just dislike them both?
I just wouldn't cheer for anybody. I would just watch basketball, and if there's a crazy play, I would cheer. First pitch to McDonald's over the plate for strike number one.
Probably how most GCU fans feel. Would love to see New Mexico State get beat by 50. Oh, yeah. Everybody nodding their heads up here. They'd love to see New Mexico. No conference love? No, not at all. Okay. We're being selfish up here. We just want New Mexico State to get drilled.
Want New Mexico State to get drilled after Ian Baker got conference player of the year. Many GCU people not agreeing with that decision by the coaches, as you were talking about last night.
Yeah.
Would be very interested to see how the coaches voted and see which coaches voted for Ian Baker and which ones voted for Dwayne Russell.
Yep.
The 0-2 to McDonald, ground ball, left side, high chopper, right at Ping.
Wow.
And the strong, long throw over from third base from Ping.
Boy, he just decided to bare hand that one. That's a that's a gutsy play, too. But Ping, we've seen it twice, and Ping just bare hands it, strong arm, and gets his man. So, quickly two up, two down.
Brings up the number nine batter, Mark Mumper, who's reached base twice today. Walked in the second and then hit a two RBI single up the middle in the fourth. That put the game at 3-0 for GCU, but now it's a 4-3 ball game after the Dons hung a three spot up in the top half of this frame. Mark Mumper looking for a bunt single. Steele cuts it off. The throw to first base, not in time. A bunt single, two singles for Mark Mumper in the day. He's two for two today.
Yeah, he double clutched it. It looked like it probably should have given away to the third baseman, Ping, coming in on the ball and his momentum taking him to first base. And that's going to be an interesting call there because you see he beats it by about a half a step or so. And the pitcher, Steele, double clutched that thing trying to pick it up. So we'll have to wait and see what the official scoring on that is. But difficult play. Had to come over and make the play. Either way, Mumper on again for the third time of the day.
It officially goes down as an E1, but his on-base percentage today is 1,000. Back to the top of the lineup, GCU goes, and Austin Bull gets his first at-bat from the left side here against Steele, the switch hitter, middle infielder for GCU. The top of the lineup, he's 1-for-3 today. Single and a run scored in the first. Pitch outside.
First at bat from the left side here. In this one, right? Yeah, he all three previous at bats were against Granoff, the lefty.
Steele's worked an inning in a third so far. Hasn't given up any runs. Given up just one hit as well. That last at bat from Mumper going down as an E1. Steele comes set, long pause out there, delivers home. It's 3-0 now to the leadoff batter, Austin Bull, with a runner at first base.
Yeah, Bull coming into this game, hitting 222 against lefties, but 400 against righties. So they flip him around here. And the majority of his at-bats have come against righties, like we said. So Coach Stankiewicz down there at third, not getting anything going again in there for a strike 3-1, maybe here with a 3-1 count. Hasn't been really doing a lot of hit and run. Bull's got a great eye. I want to see if he can work a walk and bring Signs up.
Signs, a solo shot in the fifth to lead things off. That's the only difference between the two clubs right now after the Dons put three runs up in the away half. Bumper takes off, hit and run applied, lifted to left field right at Sinatra. That'll end the inning. So no runs, no hits, one error, one left on base for GCU. Here in the sixth, we head to the seventh. GCU hanging on to a one-run lead here over the Dons here on GCU TV.
Grand Canyon University's newly remodeled golf course is thriving in the heart of Phoenix, featuring over 7,200 yards of expansive tees and tree-lined fairways, signature par threes, greenside bunkers, premium greens, and a brand new clubhouse and restaurant. Experience a university championship golf course this summer with great rates as low as $15 available now. Book your tee times at gcugolf.com.
Fletcher Lycan, Michael Potter along here for the seventh inning. Jake Repovich out on the mound, sending things back over to Michael Potter. He'll finish out the game here on GCU TV.
Yeah, thanks, Fletcher. You know, this game a lot tighter here. Three runs on the board in the top of the sixth inning for San Francisco. That's the only time Jake Repovich has struggled, and it was really just pitching behind batters. You know, he could not place that first pitch. And pitching behind the batters, they scored the three runs, the big hit, the double by Puss Christian, followed up by the two RBI single by Marolio. The Lopes, one in the first, two in the fourth, one in the fifth, and you just look down this entire series. When the Lopes score, it's one or two, maybe three typically. When the Dons score, it's three plus, a five-run inning, a six-run inning. I mean, they just put a lot of runs on the board when they get the opportunity.
They're deadly on the base paths, and they put a lot of pressure on you, and that's when they can pounce. They get a couple runners on, and then all of a sudden they hang a big crooked number up.
Ping to lead things off. First pitch in there for a strike. That's good to see. Ping, Helland, and Bate do up for the Dons. Let's look real quickly here. 68 pitches. So Repovich, even though he struggles with that six, boy, he still looks pretty good from the pitch count. Swing and a miss, strike two. And, you know, not that you're scared to go to your bullpen if you're the Lopes, but you're a little scared to go to your bullpen if you're the Lopes. So you're hoping the Repovich can either get you a complete game or get you to the eighth or the ninth, and then, you know, maybe you go with Franks or Vorhoff again, the 0-2. Swing and a miss, struck him out. That's a way to come back, kid. That's a fifth strike out of the ball game.
That's exactly what Repovich needed after that rocky sixth inning. He needed to start things off strong, and that's what he did, coming in with a strikeout there to Ping.
Yeah, and if you look at this lineup that the Dons, and they're going to win a lot of games in the West Coast Conference. I mean, they were picked to finish fourth as Helland steps in. You look at this lineup, and really the only kind of weaknesses you can point out are 5, 6, and 7. I mean, you know, they're top four in this lineup today, and that one's in the left field for a base that looked good. Their bottom two looked good, and Helland, you know, heard me talking about him being a weak spot and drove one into left field for a base hit. So with one out, one man on, that'll bring up Bernie Bate. They're really good all the way up and down the order. And Manny Ramirez Jr., who played the first two, as we're going to get a pinch runner down there first. Manny Ramirez Jr. played the first two, has been really, you know, not great hitting, but when he connects, he just drives the ball. So you put him in there. And that, you know, not playing in this one, but you put him in there, and that really lengthens out the lineup as well. We got a pinch runner trying to get the number here. Number 20?
Pinch runner for the Dons.
So we got a pinch runner.
Harrison Bruce.
Oh, that's Harrison Bruce. Yeah, he started the first two ball games. Another fast runner played out in right field, and he's for Helland. So I'm assuming you'll put Marolio back there behind the plate. They got it picked off. Again, they got him. So
wow.
They put the runner in, and boy, Bruce was not only frozen or going back, he was heading the other way.
Great pickoff there from Repovich.
Great camera view right here, and oh boy, you're talking about that 45-degree angle becoming 60. You saw it right there, and boy, but Yeah, I mean, it, look, they didn't call it or anything, and that just froze the runner. Actually had him going the other way. So, once again, great pickoff. First pitch in there to bait a strike. And you didn't get any argument. I mean, that is a call that the umpire, the coach can come out and argue if he wants to. They don't like it when you argue balls and strikes, but you can come out and ask a question on that one, and they didn't. Rip down the line, and that pickoff is huge now as Bates rounding first, heading for extra bases. Cotton gets it in the corner, loses the ball, drops it. Now Bates going to try for third. A good throw would get him, but they cut it off, and he's in there. So a double and an air. Brady Bate on base for the second time. Boy, Cotton just whiffed on it down in the corner when Bate had to play right in front of him. Fast runner. No way he was going to stay off at third base. And that would have scored the run right there. We would have been tied. So that pickoff of Repovich, huge right here.
Unfortunately, it brings up Villa Roman, who scored after walking in the sixth to lead things off. And then it's back at the top of the lineup for the Dons, and they've been able to score some runs when they get guys on base. And Bate at third base is not somebody you want to have up with Villa Roman and then the top of the lineup due up.
That pitch misses. Oh, Repovich going to have to pitch himself out. We got some action down in the pen down there. Is that Malachi throwing down in the pen? I think it might be. I'm going to go with Bobby Malachi in the pen, but we're going to get eagle eyes to my right here to take a look at it. The 1-0. Missed outside 2-0. It is. Bobby Malachi out there. And, you know, when you look at Malachi's numbers in this series, he got a 5.4 ERA and 1 2/3. He gave up 4 hits and 3 runs. But he got two bouncers to the middle infield that were misplayed. You know, Malachi actually pitched pretty well, I thought. That one hit a drive in the center. But Kona's right there to make the grab. And Repovich gives up the base hit to Helen. Picks him off. At first, the pinch runner Bruce, and then the double by Bate, which went to a triple after the air, but gets Villa Roman to line out sharply at ball to center field, and the Lopes get out of the inning unscathed. No runs, two hits, one error, and a man left on base. We go to the bottom of the seventh, 4-3, GCU still clinging to that one-run lead.
This weekend on GCU.TV, watch men's volleyball take on Indiana Purdue Fort Wayne. Friday at 6 p.m. and Saturday at 6 p.m. here on GCU TV.
New catcher in the ball game, as we expected. Marolio moves from DH to catcher. Now, Bruce, we'll see if Bruce gets back into this ball game here. Still Villa Roman in center and Sinatra in left. Bate, I'd imagine, will stay in too. So Bruce will just go in there and take over that designated hitter role. But 4-3, GCU with the lead. The Lopes put one on the board in the first, two in the fourth, one in the fifth. Looked to be cruising. Repovich gave up three in the sixth, a 4-3 ball game. And I think that might have been his last inning, although the pitch count, he could still go out there again. Probably Coach Stengel would try to get him through the eighth inning here, because he pitched around some trouble in that seventh innings, but some nice pitching by Repovich and really helped himself out with picking off the pinch runner Harrison Bruce.
That was huge. It was a great throw over to first base too. Was continuing his motion up, kind of looked like he paused, but he still technically was moving. And then a great throw over to first base, that 45 degree angle turning into 60 kind of, but it's definitely in that in between that eventually it's going to become a conversation in the world of baseball of whether it's actually 45 degrees or they're pushing that degree angle, and eventually you might start to see some rules and some new baseball laws applied to that pickoff for lefties.
So for the Lopes, signs Evans and Short. Signs last time he led off an inning, he had a solo homer up high, almost caught him. That was the last batter that Granoff, the starter for the Dons, faced. That solo homer by Signs. Now Greg in 310 on the year with two homers and three RBI. So two homers, but just three RBI to show for it. A couple solo shots. Taking a hack and fouling that one back. Like the way this guy swings the bat. He's a guy that ever since his freshman year, I've been watching him saying, man, you got to find a way to get this guy in the lineup. And Coach Stenko is the same thing. I got to get this guy's bat in the lineup. Tried him at second, tried him at third, tried him at first. He plays pretty well over there. needs to improve on that. But as a DH, it's a perfect spot for him. But Cuba Best is playing really well, too, as that one catches a corner. 1-2 to count the sign. So the way he swings the bat, they want to find him a spot to play.
It's really tough to find him a spot to play when you have Evans at first, Nallis at third, and Austin Bull in the middle half of the middle part of the infield as well. I mean, unless you want to throw him behind the plate and try him out there, there's not really a lot of options for him other than DH and second base.
Right, yeah, and he plays a pretty good second base, but, I mean, we've talked about, you know, you'd like to see Mumford take over that shortstop role and move Bull to second. That's probably where the team's better defensively with those two guys up the middle. And Ian Evans isn't going anywhere at first base, and Malice isn't going anywhere at third base. Chopped foul. Oh, nice grab down there. Who was that? Hanging over, just reached out, backhanded, grabbed it. Number 36 for GCU. Was that what the number was? We don't have anybody number 36. Was that Hanson? I don't know. Somebody made a nice play down there, snagging that one. Yeah, see it right there? Boom. Just reach out, grab it. Whoever it was a nice play. The 1-2.
That looked like Jack Schneider.
Ooh. Hit him in the back. So signs on again, earns it the hard way, and that'll bring up Ian Evans. We have a scoring correction. That bunt has been switched from an air to a single, so give Mumper a single on that one. It was a play that could have gone either way, and our folks up here looked at it a couple times on the replay and looked up the official rules there and made the decision that that was should go as a base. It was a nice bunt, so now that's been switched, and the Lopes have 9 base hits on the day. Evans attacking the first pitch, gets under and fouls it back.
Dropped his back shoulder a little bit there, getting underneath that one. It was a good pitch from Steele. Evans unable to stay on top of that ball, however, with the runner at first base.
Is that Marley? Looking at a replay of a of a foul ball at the Diamondbacks. Nice play, just like one of our guys made down there. 0-1 count to Evans. Here in the seventh, it'd be nice to see the Lopes throw a few on the board here to extend that lead. Signs with his lead. More than likely not a threat to go, especially with the heart of the order up Evans. It's going to hang up there. Villaroman able to come in and make the grab. Hit that well, but it hung up and bent back toward Villaroman just a bit for the first out of the inning, and Sines heads back to first. Well, the good thing about Evans, even when he makes an out, they're typically loud outs. He's been squaring the ball up really well. And now Garrison Schwartz with a chance to face a right-hander again. He ground out the second the last time he faced Joey Steele, who came on in relief of Granoff in the fifth. Throw over and Sines back. I don't expect Sines to be going anywhere here, but see if Coach Stankiewicz wants to do something. You know, Gary's been struggling a bit here at the plate. Fouls that one off the right side. Schwartz hitting 205 on the year with one homer, 7 RBI. I mean, we know what he's capable of. Just hasn't got rolling yet.
Greg Sines hasn't tried to swipe any bags so far this year, so Steele's probably just making sure he's not going anywhere on a hit and run or getting too big of a jump with Greg, with Garrison Schwartz batting, because if Garrison Schwartz can put one in the gap and Sines gets a good jump at first base, he could score from first.
Cat goes to 1-1 on Gary. Missed outside, so now a good hitter's count. 2 balls and 1 strike to Garrison Schwartz. When you look at Schwartz, it's 133 against lefties, 250 this year against righties. But overall, he's always been a better hitter against right-handers. There he does go. Swing and a miss on the hit and run. The throw in time. Well, he was looking back the entire way, so that was a straight hit and run, and Garrison Schwartz just swung right through it. So Coach Stankiewicz trying to get something going here, and that's normally not a play you'd make with your cleanup hitter, but that's more to show you that Garrison Schwartz has been scuffling a bit. That is why you make that call. Just trying to get something going.
Try to get something going, unable to do so. Garrison Schwartz really struggling at the plate so far. Really scuffling, as you said, and he's going to need to continue to get ABs. He's a batter that once he gets going, it's going to be tough to stop him, but he just needs to get going.
Ground ball to second, and that is the inning. Well, the Lopes get the leadoff man aboard with the hit by pitch, but the line out to center are caught stealing and the ground down. No runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left on base. We have completed seven innings. Repovich back on the hill for the eighth. This is Lopes Baseball on GCU TV.
I am Laura Lozoya, and I am majoring in biology with an emphasis in pre-med at Grand Canyon University. The dorm life at GCU definitely helped me build relationships, and I've made great friends on this campus. The quality education here is great. You're testing your limits, but you're going beyond them. It all comes together, the sciences, the ethics, and just everything. It's a beautiful thing.
Grand Canyon University, the quality of a private Christian education, the affordability of a state university. Visit GCU.com.
Well, fans staying out of direct contact with the sun down there, but enjoying a beautiful day here. You know, mid 80s to low 90s. A little bit of a breeze going here, and the Lopes with a 4-3 lead as we go to the eighth. Repovich back on the hill. We had mentioned that, you know, you little nerves going to the bullpen for GCU this year, so they want to get as much out of Repovich as they can. And Jake back on the hill in seven innings, just seven hits, three runs. They were all three earned. He struck out five, walked one, and thrown 78 pitches. So, I mean, quite frankly, if he has a good inning here, Jake could even come out for the ninth. But he'll have to go through the top of the order. Sinatra, Giaritano, and Puskarich, and those guys have been doing the damage in this one. Sinatra, 1-for-3, singled and scored back in the sixth. Chopper down the line, fair ball, got past Malice. Sinatra turning on the speed into second with a double. Well, Cotton made a nice play on that out there to get to it and get the ball back in to second as quickly as possible. But Sinatra leadoff double. He's now 2-for-4. And you watch this throw in. Boy, he's just hustling and had the play in front of him the whole way. Slid a little bit late, popped up and beats the throw. Nice job by Bull holding that tag on the hip of the runner, because if he had hopped off of there too early, would have got the out. But now you got Giaritano, man already in scoring position. Probably no need to bunt to move him up to third. We'll see what Nico's dad, Nino, decides to do here. Giaritano has not figured out Jake Repovich, 0-for-3. To head back to the bag. Well, we are doing the selection Sunday today with the NCAA. He is going to bunt in the air, let it go foul there. Looked like Malice had a late break, going to be back there at third base, and they want Repovich to cover that left side there. If Malice had been charging, he might have been able to catch that ball, but it looks like the play they're putting on is to have Malice back there at third. So just in case it's bunted right at somebody, they can try to get the runner at third. But, boy, that's going to be a tough one, because Sinatra very fast, and he's getting a big lead out there and a great secondary lead.
Dons are really trying to tie this ball game up. No outs in the inning, runner at second base, moving a guy over to third base with Giaritano. Put a hurt on the GCU here with Puskarich and Morolio due up.
And now Troy Nakamura going to talk to his shortstop, Nico Giaritano. That's a very quick conversation, but everybody from the left side coming in to chat with McDonald and Repovich. There we go. They've revealed. It looks like they've got the East revealed, the Midwest, and the South.
UNC get a number one seed.
Yeah.
Kansas and Nova.
Yeah, looks like it. Spin around and runner goes back. Yeah, so it looks like Nova, the number one seed in the East. That makes sense.
So
KU in the Midwest, which is a little bit odd after losing that first round or second round of the tournament, but not huge. And then UNC.
Well, so then does Gonzaga get that other number one seed, or do they think they slide into a two spot?
Out in the West, we'll have to wait and see. In there for a strike. So Gonzaga the one and Arizona two in the West. I like that.
It's going to be a tough regional.
Yeah, that's a good one.
See if Gonzaga can finally get over the hump. They've always had good basketball teams, but Mark Few's club's never able to finally get over that hump. Whether that's in the Final Four or the Elite Eight, they just haven't been able to finish. Maybe they pull Coastal Carolina and finally get over the hump.
Let's throw back and the runner back. Yeah, the interesting thing out there is the Gonzaga with the number one seed, their first game is against San Diego State, the number 16 seed.
San Diego State got a 16 seed, wow.
Yeah. Oh, South Dakota State, sorry.
I was gonna say.
I was like, holy cow, I didn't know they won their tournament. South Dakota State, 22-11 on the year. Have we ever had a one get beaten in the first? We've had a two get beaten, right?
Almost happened last year with the one seed going down. Almost happens a lot. But almost only counts in horseshoes and hand grenades and slow dancing. Sorry, that's close. And shaving.
Dorman having a chat out here. The tying run is at second base. That's Sinatra. Nobody out. They tried to bunt a couple of times with Giaritano. And he hasn't been able to get the ball down. So now two strikes on him, Giaritano. He's swinging away here. So a lot of strategy going on here in the eighth inning. Bounce it up there. Good block by McDonald. Now Frank's throwing out there. Malachi has taken a seat. So it looks like Frank's will be the first out of the bullpen here. Repovich trying to get through this inning. Swing and a miss in the dirt. Throw down to first. They get the runner. So Repovich gets his sixth strikeout of the ball game. That'll bring up Puskarich. Puskarich had that double to drive in a run and came in to score the third run of the ball game on the base hit single by Marolio. And now that's going to be it. Stankiewicz is going to go to the pen. So Repovich is going to be done here, and he's going to bring in A.J. Franks. So Repovich, a splendid job today, pitching into the eighth. He'll go 7 1/3 and leave with the lead. But this has been the time that's been a little bit dicey for GCU when they've gotten a good outing from their starter. And this has been maybe the best outing of the year for a starter. Wong has a couple of great outings. But Repovich, just a phenomenal outing here as he walks off the mound. And this has been the time, though, where the Lopes have struggled, just holding on to those leads.
And this is where the bullpen needs to grow up a little bit here in a really pressure-packed situation. Runner on second base. Repovich is responsible for the runner at second. But A.J. Franks showed it against Oklahoma State that he can battle with the best, and he's going to need to show that here again today in the sun here against San Francisco if he's going to want to give Repovich the win here or hopefully give him the win, because you don't want to give Repovich another no decision after tonight's performance.
Right, yeah, Jake pitched a great game yesterday, Wong, and got the no decision, and Frank's pitched in that game. We'll give you those numbers in a minute, but the 6'2 senior at Anaheim, California, and Santa Ana College on relief here, and you look at Frank's number, 6.97 ERA. This is his seventh appearance. He does have one save, but in 10 1/3, he's given up 14 hits, 8 runs. They were all earned. He's walked one and struck out 5 in opposition, hitting .341 against A.J. And, you know, you look back to what he did last year in 24 appearances, had a .273 ERA, and in 26 1/3, he only gave up 8 earned runs the entire season last season. He gave up 14 total, but 8 earned runs. He's already given that up here with eight earned runs on eight runs. So, yeah, AJ's got a chance here to kind of redeem himself a bit from the other night, but gonna have to buckle down, and it's a tall order as he's gonna face Marolio, or excuse me, Puskarich first and then Marolio. But these are the guys that really have given the Lopes trouble in this series. That ball game yesterday, you had it pretty much set up how you wanted it with Wong going six, but Franks came in and threw two innings, gave up four hits, three runs, all earned. Well, still had a chance to win that thing, didn't give up the lead, but into right field, coming in, making the grab. Schwartz have a chance at second to throw back, not in time. Well, one pitch, the second out of the inning. That ball was hit well by Puskarich, trying to go the same way. He hit that double down the right field line. But this one, a nice play by Schwartz. Two down. Sinatra back at second, but the ever-dangerous Dominic Marolio singled in a couple runs back in the sixth, had the two-run homer in the ballgame yesterday. That was the game winner in that one. Has a chance to put his team ahead here. He's already driven one to the base of the wall. Throw to second. Ooh, quick tag there by Bull. Man. And AJ just spun and threw. Sinatra getting a big lead. He knows, man, on a base hit, even a single right at somebody in the outfield, he's going to try to score, tie this thing up. He's got good speed. With two outs, he can just be flying. The crack of the bat. Boy, Marolio really takes a big hack at the ball. It fouls that one off his foot.
Giratano's teams love to run on base paths as well. We've seen it all series long. 26 total stolen bases, and they're not going to shy away from having Sinatra try to swipe home plate here if there's a ball in play, even if it's right out of an outfielder, like you said.
Bull trying to keep him close. Now AJ's just going to spin around and send him back. Well, the danger in this is you get a little too concerned about the guy out there, and you do have to be concerned about him, but if you lose any focus here and get one up to Marolio, he can take you out of the park and lose you the game on one swing of the bat. 0-1. Right on the outside corner for the strike. AJ one strike away. The Lopes were one strike away from a win in the ball game last night, and everything fell apart. Five runs came across for the Dons. Now we're taking a little time. Here's AJ making sure everything's all set, and now moving the center fielder Quinn Quigel, or Kona Quigel, back over toward Quinn Cotton over there in left. A bit of a gap in right center. 0-2. Strike on the outside corner, but he didn't call it. Was that the exact same spot as the one before it?
Looks pretty darn close from up here. We even had the special zoomed in angle there from that camera. And wow, that was close. John Flanagan not giving that one to AJ Franks.
Wow, that was a tough no call right there. What a pitch. And can AJ do it again? The 1-2. Fouled it off, kept it alive. Yeah, I think Flanagan missed one there. That looked like the exact same pitch as the one before that was a strike and looked really good. But it's one ball, two strikes with two outs. Sinatra on second. He's the tying run. We're in the top of the eighth inning, 4-3 GCU. Throw back to second. Sinatra back. Pretty good gap in right center field, but from what we've seen, Marolio is a pretty much straight dead pull hitter. But he hits it to right center field. Hits it well, but Gary's there, and that is the inning. So the Lopes, the leadoff double to Sinatra, the strikeout of Giaritano. Repovich leads the game. Puskrich a line out to right, and Murillo a line out to right. And we go to the bottom of the eighth. Still a 4-3 lead for GCU.
West Side Story, the classic tale of a turf war between rival teenage gangs, opens in Ethington Theater on March 31st. This spin on Romeo and Juliet has been captivating audiences for decades, and this production will be no exception. Get your tickets now at gcu.edu/west.
Well, for the Lopes, 4 runs, 9 hits, 1 error, 6 left on base. And for the Dons, 3 runs, 8 hits, no errors, and 4 left on base. Joey Steele back out there again to pitch for the Dons. He came on in relief of this ball game in the fifth inning after Sines hit a solo homer to make it a 4-0 lead here. But that run is the difference right now. That solo shot, the last pitch Sam Granoff threw in this ball game, the difference in it as Lopes lead it 4-3. It'll be Quinn Cotton, Zach Malice, and Kona Quiggle unless we get a pinch hitter here in the bottom of the eighth. Cotton, a couple of base hits his last two times up. It's 2-for-3 in this one. Malice is 0-for-3. And Kona Quiggle is 1-for-3. So no action in the pen. Looks like A.J. Franks is going to just try to close this one out himself in the ninth. See if the Lopes can give him a few more runs to work with here. Misses down low, ball one. Don't forget, folks, to stick around after this game ends. And Coach Stankiewicz makes his way up, or we'll have an interview with the skipper, talk about the series in totality here. Hopefully we'll be talking after a W. Under the glove of the third baseman into left field. Cotton 3-for-4, 3 straight singles.
Have a day, Quinn Cotton, freshman coming in. Needed to get some hits on the board. He's got 3 singles, and they've been all over the place. One down the line to first, one down the line to third, and one through the first and second base hole. And he hasn't been able to be defended so far, and you can't really put a shift on him. You can't play guys in certain spots. He's going to spread all over the place.
Malice already squaring to bunt. It's going to bunt. Pitch misses down low and away. So Zach struggling a bit here, 0-for-3 in this one. So Andy Stank was going to ask him to drop a bunt down, move the runner, a nice insurance run over to second.
I like this move by Coach Stankiewicz to have one of your guys that you know has muscle and has a big bat. If he can bunt, you know he's a quality player. A little throw underhand there from Steele. But if I'm Andy Stankiewicz, everybody on my lineup is able to bunt the ball, even if it's Garrison Schwartz or Zach Malice or Ian Evans. That makes you a well-rounded baseball player, and it makes you a team player as well. It's not all about you. It's a team effort, not just one guy wins a ball game. And putting Cotton at second base after that sacrifice bunt is exactly what GCU needs here in the eighth, trying to get some insurance runs.
So the sack bunt works to perfection, and the Lopes now have another run. Possibility out there at second, man in scoring position for Kona Quiggle. Base hit single his first time up, reached on a fielder's choice and scored in the fourth, and then ground out to the first baseman his last time up. Breaking pitch, he waited on it and swung through it. And now Murillo going to come out and chat with his pitcher. I think he's kind of reminding him that the signs are different with the runner at second base, because it looked like he was expecting a fastball there. Got the off-speed pitch, but it fooled the batter, too. No balls and one strike to count. And now that, because the shortstop, Giaritano came in as well to remind everybody and make sure they were talking about the right signs. Cotton takes his lead. The 0-1. Outside. 1-1. Thank you. Still a good crowd out here for this ball game. Enjoying the nice weather and another good game. The 1-1. Way outside.
Lost that one in his hand there. You saw it slip out of his hand, not when he wanted to release that ball. Steal, leaving that breaking ball outside. Good 2-3 feet off the plate there. That one just lost it. He just lost that ball out of his hand.
Now you see the runner at second base causing a little trouble for the Dons pitchers here. They're trying to keep an eye on him. Loops lead it, 4-3. Another double-digit hitting effort for GCU. Way outside again. So now all of a sudden, Steele can't find the plate. We got a lefty warming up down there. I think that's Parker who came into the ball game. Yeah, Scott Parker, the lefty warming up in the bullpen for the Dons. Parker pitched in the opening game of this series, the 3-1. Outside, he walked him. So now you got runners at first and second. And gonna get a pinch hitter, Cuba Bess. But this might make Giratano go, and he is gonna go to his left-hander.
Number 28, Cuba.
So they announced Cuba Bess as a pinch hitter for Jared McDonald. I would imagine you're gonna get then Barnes to come in, but Giratano gonna come out and make the call to the bullpen. He's gonna get Parker to come in. So now they're playing a little bit of the numbers here. They put Bess up there, the lefty against the righty, but now the Dons bring in their left-handed pitcher, Parker. So it'll be a lefty-lefty matchup here. Number 22, Scott Parker, the 5'8 redshirt sophomore out of Laguna Niguel, California. Scott Parker at 2.45 ERA. This will be his ninth appearance, all out of the pen. In 7 1/3, he's given up 5 hits, 2 runs, both earned. He's walked 4 and struck out 6. So Parker on for his second relief appearance in this series. In the first one, Parker went an inning and a third, gave up 1 hit, walked a guy, but didn't allow a run. So now Bess was going to be against the righty. Got a chance here against a lefty. Cuba, the freshman for GCU, hitting .387 on the year. No homers, but 5 RBI. Got the start in the ball game yesterday as well as on Friday. Cuba in this series hitting .556, 5 for 9 with 4 runs scored, 2 RBI, has a couple of doubles. So Bess and Bull having the best series here. Bess gets a chance against the lefty Parker. It's a 4-3 GCU lead. We're in the bottom of the 8th inning. And Bess has yet to get a base hit off a left-hander. He's 0-for-7 against lefties this season.
He's 0-for-7, but 1-for-8, and it's a 5-3 ball game.
There you go. Bess has looked good, and we talked about it. Get these freshmen more at-bats, and you got basically the three freshmen that you're really counting on over the next 4 years. You got Cotton out at second. You got Quiggle at first. And you got Bess at the plate. And that's why you recruited these guys.
And Bess is somebody you didn't really expect to get a lot of ABs either, the way that the lineup was starting to show up at the beginning of the season, especially against Oklahoma State. But the way that the next two series is gone and then the way that this series started, Cuba Bess has been thrown into the lineup, and he's 5-for-9 so far in the series.
Parker's first pitch in there for a strike, the breaking pitch. Cotton taking his lead at second. Up the middle. Could be 2. Second for 1. Back to first. Head first dive, but they got it. Well, slickly turned by the infield there, and the Lopes will go to the ninth with just a 1-run lead. 4-3 your score here as we go to the ninth. Lopes looking to salvage one game of this 3-game series here on GCU TV. Grand Canyon University.
There's an exciting new destination for food, fun, and relaxation in the heart of Phoenix. Come to GCU Hotel and Canyon 49 Grill, where our hospitality management students gain hands-on workplace experience and deliver unmatched service right alongside the staff. Enjoy beautiful amenities like the resort-style pool and full-service fitness center. From the gaming lawn and patio to the artisanal coffee and teas of GCBC, you'll never want to leave. Room rate $79 per night. Visit GCUHotel.com to book your visit today.
A.J. Franks out there to try to get those elusive final three outs of a ball game. The Lopes led by two going into the ninth inning yesterday and ended up losing that ball game after the Dons put a five spot on the board in the top of the ninth. Here they lead by one. 4-3 your score as we go to the ninth. Four runs, 10 hits, one error, seven left on for GCU. Three runs, eight hits, no errors, four left on for San Francisco. Griffin Barnes back behind the plate as we thought. And, you know, Fletcher, now six double-digit hit games in a row for GC, the most since seven consecutive double-digit hit performances. Yeah, back in April of 2015 at UTPA, Northern Colorado, and New Mexico. And that team was number seven in division, one in average. So GCU hitting the ball well. The Achilles heel has just been this back end of the bullpen.
Yeah, I just wrote that down, actually. Six straight games. Was wondering what the record was in Division I play. You brought it up. But that pitching, we talked about in that series finale against Oklahoma State, trying to figure out that back end of the bullpen. The three starters have been solidified. The Jakes are absolutely phenomenal so far throughout the season. But that Achilles heel, like you said, has been the back end of the bullpen. They haven't been able to close out games. They haven't been dominant like they've needed to be. They're not dominant like a conference tournament and a conference, regular season conference title team would be. You can't just have your starters and then hope that the other team is going to lay down. You have to be dominant from start to finish, and that includes your relievers, because you can't get a complete game out of every single starter.
Perry, Ping, and Bruce here in the ninth. That went in there for a strike, 2-2 to Perry. Perry has been hitting the ball on the ground, a ground out to third in the second, a ground out to short in the fifth, and grounded to a double play in the sixth. Another ground ball. Malice off the glove. Throw, not in time. So leadoff man aboard with the E5, tying run aboard with the E5, and I said and almost kind of pinned it on the back end of the bullpen. It's really been the bullpen in general, but it's also been the defense. When the Lopes need to make a play, and that wasn't necessarily a difficult play, had to range a bit, but you see him make it all the time. And Malice would tell you that's a play he should make every time. So we've seen the Lopes put themselves into bad positions with poor defense, and then the pitchers have not been able to pitch out it, pitch around the poor defense.
That's a play Malice needs to make. It's a play he makes 9 times out of 10,
yeah,
maybe even 99 times out of 10, running to his left. He made some difficult plays earlier in the game, but that one eludes him there. It's double plays in order, but you don't want to get to the top half of the batting lineup for the Dons.
Going around the bunt, try to get that tying run to second is Ping. Ping's 0 for 3. That one misses ball one. And the time that the Lopes have had trouble here in this ball game, they've been pitching behind the batters. And Austin Bull comes in to say something to his pitcher. Looks like Smoot has a bat and ready to pinch hit in the on-deck circle. Smoot started the first two ball games here against the Lopes. Would be coming in to pinch hit for Harrison Bruce, who came in to pinch run for Riley Helland and then was picked off first base. Not bunting this time, in the air. Coming in on it. Making the grab is Kona Quiggle. And, boy, that's a big play right there, because they went away from the bunt. And I don't know if they missed a sign or if this decided not to bunt the man over. But either way, it's a fly out to center. And now the Lopes, with the ground ball, could turn two and get the victory here. And it will be number five, Alan Smoot. Smoot, the 6'1" redshirt senior out of Moraga, California, going to come up to the plate. Well, that was an interesting call there. You would have thought, you're playing to tie this game up, that you just bunt the man over. And they tried the first time, but did not the second time here. Smoot's numbers, 273 on the year. No homers, 12 RBI, has four doubles on the season. And this is the first game he didn't start or play in until now. Started both games at third base. Was 2-for-10 in this series, but did have a couple of RBI.
Struck out a handful of times as well, so A.J. Franks, if he can get ahead in the count here, could put Smoot in a difficult situation. Maybe strike him out for the fifth time in the series.
Fastball missed up high and away. Vorhoff warming in the pin.
You don't want to have to use Vorhoff if you're GCU. You want to just be able to ride A.J. Franks through this. Just one pitch can end the game.
Down low, 2-0. Well, you don't want to walk the run into scoring position here. I mean, Perry down there, not necessarily a big threat to steal, and they haven't gone and put a pinch runner in to try to steal a bag or anything. That one caught the outside corner. So working away from Smoot here, finally get one across the edge. Two balls and one strike to count.
If you keep pitching away from him, Smoot gets tries to get in front of it and pull it, you're going to get him to ground out for sure. He'll just roll over to the second baseman or the shortstop. And that would end the game most likely here for GCU with that middle infield that's solidified.
There goes the runner, fouled back. Pretty good jump. Two balls and two strike to count. They tried to get something going there.
I like that A.J. Franks came up in the zone there, gets Smoot to pop that one up and out of play. Going from outside, then coming up middle part of the zone there, but A.J. Franks doing a good job changing the location of each pitch.
Dan James in the on-deck circle. Looks like he's going to pinch hit for bait. Two-two pitch, not going. Foul back. Just working on that outside part of the plate. Placing it well here. Lopes up by one. One out here in the ninth with the tying run at first base. Dan James, the on-deck hitter, is 1-for-13 this season. Fastball just missed. Boy, it sure looked like Flanagan might have flinched behind on plate. That one looked a little off possibly, but twice now in consecutive innings, Franks has been pinched on the outside corner there, once against Marolio and now here against Smoot. Three balls, two strikes, one out. Let's see if they get the runner going here. Lope still holding him on. Payoff pitch, there he goes. Hitting the right field, Schwartz, the fielder on a hop. The throw, not going to be in time, but a good throw and was low enough that the runner couldn't advance, but now a base hit makes the runners at the corner. So Smoot comes in, pinch hit, gets a base knock, and now Perry down there at third. And it will be now number 23, Dan James. James, as we mentioned, senior infielder, hitting under 100, a .077 batting average, just 1-for-13. This will be his 10th game played, but hasn't started. Are they going to bring in Vorhoff? Looks like they're going to bring in Vorhoff. So Andy Stankiewicz has seen enough out of A.J. Franks, and now he's going to bring in Vorhoff. And Vorhoff made this trot less than 24 hours ago, and it didn't work out well for him. We'll see if he gets to come in here and get a chance to get that out of his mind. And if you're a closer, you got to have a short-term memory here. And hopefully, saw Mick earlier today, and it didn't seem like he was worried about anything. So he's got to come out here and just throw strikes and try to get a ground ball here for GCU, because the tying run just 90 feet away, the go-ahead run is down at first base.
Definitely not the situation that Stankiewicz wanted here, having to really hold his breath here with his bullpen trying to save the game again. And could be another nail biter here for GCU, relying on Vorhoff and Franks to close this one out.
Well, and if you're the Lopes, you know, it's a great chance for Mick Vorhoff to come in here and right the ship after having that disastrous game last night. Vorhoff has pitched well for the Lopes in his career with GCU. He's trying to get back on track. The junior, 6 foot 1 inches tall from Sammamish, Washington, and East Lake High School. You look at Mick's numbers, though, this year, not good. A 10.8 ERA, a record of 0-2. He does have one save. This will be his sixth appearance. In 6 2/3, he's given up 10 hits, 8 runs, 8 earned, 2 walks, 6 strikeouts. Opponents hitting .345 against him. And the big one here, he's given up 3 home runs, 2 in the ball game yesterday. He came into that one and really struggled through that ninth inning. When you look at his numbers, came in the ninth and gave up a leadoff double to Bruce, and a base hit single and a stolen base to Sinatra. Then he struck out Giratano and Smoot, and you thought, oh, we're in good shape here. And then the base hit single by Puskaritz to tie the game, and then the two-run homer to Maroglio, and then the solo shot to Perry. So it was a difficult afternoon, evening for Vorhoff. He had some time to think about it. Now get a ground ball, and all is forgotten here, and Lopes come away with a victory. But slimmest of margins are up 4-3 here in the ninth. Dons have runners at the corners. See the runner down at first. That's Smoot. He is the potential go-ahead run. They're going to hold him on. Don't want to get that go-ahead run down to second. First pitch to James. High and away. Ball one. Amazing how difficult it is to pitch. The difference between starting the count 0-0 to a one ball, no strike count. I mean, you got to bring something in here. You can't go 2-0, but you also got to be careful. In the air to center, hit pretty well. That should tie it up. It will tie it up. Quiggle goes back, makes the grab. So James, the pinch hit sack fly, and we got a 4-4 ball game. Exactly what you wanted for your pinch hitter. First pitch he got that was elevated a bit. And once again, Vorhoff goes down in the count. One ball, no strike. He's got to come to him. And he just reaches out and smacks it into center field for the sac fly.
Not the ending of the day that GCU wanted. Run coming across. It's unearned after he reached on an error. So tough break for GCU.
That pitch inside to Villaroman. Ball one. And for James, that's his first RBI of the year, and it comes at a perfect time. You look ahead for GCU. You got Mumper in the top of the order. That one ripped over the glove of Malice. Smoot's going to go first to third. Villaroman now has a double, and this is exactly what we talked about with this Don squad. Once they tied the game up yesterday in the ninth, they weren't satisfied and went back-to-back with a couple of home runs to really put it out of reach for the Lopes. And here, they're trying to do the same thing. Mark of a good team. Some teams just content to get that game tied up and go into extra innings. These guys are thinking, no, let's put a couple runs on the board here and win this thing and get out of here.
They're really aggressive late in games. They're not backing down at all. And they keep the pressure on GCU here, and Vorhoff's going to need a make some pitches if he wants to get out of this with a tie ball game and give his team a chance offensively to score the winning run. But you got runners on second and third now, and this is dangerous territory.
Yeah, Sinatra, the leadoff man here, who looking to bunt here. You got two outs, but Sinatra got all kind of speed, and that one's inside. And once again, Vorhoff behind the batter. But Sinatra ground out, the first time's up, and then a single and scored a run in the sixth and doubled in the eighth. So he's getting hot here. And once again, A. Jake pitches very well and is going to get a no decision here.
Tough break for Repovich after he pitched very, very well, like you said. Unfortunately, the bullpen couldn't hold up their end of the deal.
Oh, misses down low 2-0. And if you load the bases, you got Nico Giratano. You know, nobody else warming up in the pen. So, once again, you know, early on, coaches are trying to look for guys to take over roles. They go based on, oh, what you did last year, what you did in the fall. But they're really looking for you early on to solidify those roles. And in the bullpen, Nobody's done it for the Lopes. Who caught the corner. Lopes get bailed out a little bit on that one. Looked to be high and away. Now we are going to get some action down in the pin. Is that Benavides throwing down there? Gabe Benavides. I'm getting pretty good at arm actions, aren't I? Looking down there and seeing.
You do a lot of these games, Michael.
Unfortunately, I'm bragging about being able to look down at the pin and see all the different guys throwing down there. Usually it's like, oh, there's a guy for the seventh, a guy for the eighth, a guy for the ninth. But now the Lopes is trying to find anybody that can come in and get the job done. 2-1 pitch. That one too high and too far away. Three balls and one strike to Sinatra. Giratano has been ice cold. Three strikeouts, his last three times up on a flyout to right. But he's on deck, and he's a scary guy. He has six RBI in this series. Six RBI through the first two games. And he's going to hit from the left side. Which, that's where he did all of his damage in game one and two. 3-1. Ooh, strike on the outside. Sinatra has had a couple of them on the outside corner that were really close. Went for the Lopes. So now, 3-2 count, two outs. Chance for Voroff to get into the dugout. Give his offense a chance to walk one off here. The pitch. Foul tipped into the mid on a high fastball. And Sinatra really not happy with the last two strike calls. Chased that one. Strike three. So Voroff doesn't hold the lead. And the leadoff man who reached on the air comes around to score. Once again, the defense lets down the Lopes. But he keeps them at bay. A 4-4 ball game as we go to the bottom of the ninth. The Lopes with a chance to walk it off here. Mumper, Bull, and Sines due up for GCU.
Get ready to laugh out loud. Comedian and singer-songwriter Tim Hawkins is coming to GCU Arena April 1st. For his April Fool's Day comedy concert. This show is guaranteed to entertain your entire family. Tickets are just $18 with meet and greet options available. Go to the arena box office or gcuarena.com. Student discounts and group discounts are available.
Well, Brendan Jenkins on the mound, the 6'4" redshirt junior right-hander out of Pleasanton, California, also played at Cuesta College. And Jenkins with a chance here in a 4-4 ball game. Jenkins, a 1.74 ERA. This is his sixth appearance in 10 and a third. He's given up 10 hits, four runs, two earned. He's walked two and struck out nine. Opponents hitting 244 off of Jenkins. Sinatra stays in left. Need a pinch hitter for GCU too here with the righty coming in. Thomas LaRouge will get a chance to pinch it. There's a couple of changes, I think, defensively out there. We'll take a look and see. Nothing in the infield, I don't think, but we'll get those in just a second. So LaRouge, a chance to come in and pinch it. He was DHing earlier, had that labrum injury with the shoulder that limited him down the stretch last year. He did play in every ball game for the Lopes last year, but had to DH quite a bit. In that one. And then, limited just to DH, but with the emergence of Cuba Best and Greg Sines, he just kind of lost his spot when he can't play in the outfield. I mean, obviously, he would be out there if he could go with the injuries to Preston Pavlica. So Ping goes to right, and Smoot goes to third. Everybody else the same here. And so Smoot at third, and Smoot's got to look for. He's got seven errors on the season down there. But LaRouge, your pinch hitter here for GCU. And Thomas, 222, has four hits and 18 at-bats. He's got no homers and no RBI. Came in to pinch hit the other day and lofted one down the left field line. Was caught on the line. First pitch in there for a strike. Tom hit 342 last year, two homers, 26 RBI. In the air, might find a gap. It's slicing, it's diving, it's going to get in there. LaRouge on his horse, going to go for two. It's going to be tight. The throw, not in time. Leadoff double, LaRouge.
That was clutch right there. Hadn't had a lot of ABs in the last couple days. Leads things off with a first pitch double left center, and that's something that GCU's been lacking, that speed on the base paths, and Rouge showing that, hey, I've got that too, Villaroman, and I'm in the game now, and watch me run.
Yeah, first extra base hit of the season for Thomas LaRouge as he leads it off here. He is the winning run here, and now with Bull at the plate, do you bunt him over to third, so a sac fly, a wild pitch, and if that can get him in, or do you just let Bull, your best hitter, try to get one into the outfield and try to score time? He's got that speed you mentioned. Just his first extra base hit. He had 8 doubles last year. So Lopes in business here against Jenkins. They got to take advantage of it. Bull hitting 354, 1-for-4 today. Got a base hit his first time up. And then he grounded to a double play, ground out to second, and flew out to left.
The way Stankiewicz has been playing this game and managing this game, I'm not going to be surprised if Bull lays one down, but I wouldn't be surprised if he lets him swing away, being the best batter on the team.
Well, Smoot is thinking that. He's in on the grass at third.
But he's looking at second.
Isn't. Yeah, looking there, and Bull is going to bunt. Bunts it to first. They're going to go to third, and they didn't get him.
Smoot thought it was a force out at third base.
Ooh, wow.
He didn't even tag him. He held the ball like he's a first baseman. He's upset.
Wow.
He's talking into his mitt right there.
Yeah, the throw beat him, but he didn't make the tag. Wow. Wow. Yeah, that throw was there, and Smoot just, oh, my goodness. And, boy, the manager, Giratano, just livid about that. But, yeah, Smoot, the throw beat him, but you got to make the tag. And so now everybody's safe, runners at the corners and signs at the plate. And now a little sack fly possibly here, a punch went through the infield because the Don's got to bring the guys in on the grass.
That's
a big mistake. I don't know if he would have got the tag down in time because it was a high throw. The throw was definitely there, but it would have been tough to get the tag down. Now they're going to load up the bases, walk signs, and it'll be up to Ian Evans.
Dangerous, dangerous move there by the Dons to put signs on with Ian Evans coming up.
Yeah, I don't know. I like it because now you can just go home, you know, and you got that force. They're kind of in a bind. That was a tough play down there at third. Both guys really kind of nonchalanted that, you know. The Puskarich came in and fielded and just kind of lofted a throw up there around the shoulders, and then the guy at third, Smoot, didn't even try to make a tag or anything.
That's a freshman mistake there by the third baseman, but he's a redshirt senior.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's what made the coach so upset. I thought the throw was bad by Puskarich, but, yeah, not even an effort by Smoot to make a tag.
He caught the ball like a first baseman.
He just came off the
stretching
bat, yeah.
And everything. Wow. GCU catching a break there. Don's making a mistake. And GCU has the ability to win the ball game here with one swing of the bat. Put it in play. Thomas LaRouge, a leadoff double. His speed, even a suicide squeeze could almost score Thomas LaRouge with his speed.
Yeah, and with nobody out, we'll see what they do. I mean, you got your two guys you want coming up. You got Evans. I mean, he's your RBI leader. Then you got Gary behind him. Ideally, if you get away from a ground ball right at somebody, you know, that's what you want to get away from. And, boy, Giratano has seen enough of Jenkins. He's going to bring in another pitcher here. So now everybody jogs back to talk to their coaches.
Ornito will step in.
So a new pitcher, Joey Carney. So you have to bring your closer in here on this one. 6'2" redshirt senior out of Millbrae, California. Carney, a 1.64 ERA, a record of 3-1. This is his 8th appearance. He's got 2 saves on the year. In 11 innings, 8 hits, 2 runs, both earned. He's walked 3 and struck out 12. Opponents in 205 against Carney. And Carney, it's his 2nd appearance in this series. Came in and threw 2 innings, gave up 3 hits, 1 walk, 1 strikeout. So it'll be Evans, Schwartz, and Cotton due up for GCU with the bases loaded in a 4-4 ball game. Yeah, Carney came in the ball game yesterday was a pitcher of record, got the W in that one when his team erupted for five runs in the ninth. Through two innings in that one.
Coming in to pitch for the Dons, number 15, Joey Carney.
So Carney here with a record of 3-1. Vorhoff with a chance to get himself a win here if the Lopes can get just one run across.
I know this doesn't mean a lot, but I like the fact that GCU hasn't struck out a lot this series, especially in this game. GCU struck out a bunch against Oklahoma State, struck out a bunch against Wichita State. They've done very well today not to strike out. They've extended at-bats. They've put balls in play. They've put pressure on the Dons, whether that's defensively or the pitching staff of the Dons, to make pitches each time. They don't give at-bats away. And that's progress for GCU, even though the defense and the pitching isn't quite there yet. But it's progress offensively, and eventually things will start to just turn around defensively and from the pitching staff, and you'll start to see GCU put double-digit hit numbers up there, and you'll start to see some blowouts.
Bases loaded, 4-4 ball game. LaRouge at third, Bull at second, Signs at first, Evans at the plate. He's 1-for-4 in this one. Had a base hit, single to score run in the first, ground out to short in the third, a strikeout in the fifth, and a line out to center in the seventh. Everybody in on the grass on the infield. The outfielders are playing pretty shallow, although in left field, Sinatra a little bit deeper. First pitch from Carney, misses, ball one. So now Evans, head in the count. Everybody coming home on this one. LaRouge down at third. Pitch misses, high and away. 2-0. Well, no room for error here for Carney. Takes a little walk behind the mound. Carney has walked three in 11 innings. The 2-0 in there for a strike, 2-1. Good take by Evans, though, just making the reliever come to you before you swing the bat. Bases full of Lopes. The 2-1. Ground ball through the hole into left, and the Lopes get the victory here. LaRouge comes in to score. Evans walks it off with a base hit, and he's mobbed out there between first and second base. Well, it's like the Lopes just won the World Series out there, but this has been a long time coming. It's felt like just a tough go of it the entire year after that Oklahoma State series for GCU. And so this has got to feel great for the guys to get that in walk-off fashion. Evans, your transfer, your RBI leader on the squad, comes through for you, and the Lopes win it 5-4.
Yeah, that was big time, and you knew it was going to come when Thomas LaRouge led off with a double, fielder's choice for Austin Bull, and then the straight walk to Greg Sines intentionally. Ian Evans, you knew he was going to come through in the clutch, and that's what he did. He's going to be that clutch guy for GCU, and nobody is going to want to face Ian Evans when it's coming down late in the stretch of ball games.
Well, 4-8 on the year, but as we mentioned, the celebration as if they were 12-0 here on the year. But got to feel good because they've played well in certain games and just given it up by kicking the ball around, by making bad pitches, just made some silly mistakes to lose a game. So they almost did it again here today with the bullpen and the defense, but then they stick with it, come back, and get the victory in walk-off fashion before they head back out on the road. So great to see as they all go through the handshake line here. The Lopes get the win, go to 4-8 on the year, 10-6 for the Dons. And for GCU, Mick Vorhoff gets the win in this one. Vorhoff pushes his record now to 1-2 on the year. We'll be talking with the head coach, Andy Stankiewicz. I'm sure he'll chat with his group for just a few moments before he comes up here with us, and then we'll come back and chat with the coach. We'll wrap everything up, give you all the stats, and go over the numbers to get you set for the road trip that's coming up too. But first, let's step aside here. The Lopes get the victory. We'll step aside here and wanted to show you guys a little bit of a video here that was put together about the Lopes' opportunity to play ball with the pros in an exhibition game against the Diamondbacks. And some of you have heard about that. You were out there at the ballpark. But as the team celebrates and meets with the coach, we'll show you that video, then we'll come back and wrap things up. 5-4, Lopes get the victory here from Brazos Stadium.
I think it's just the experience, you know, having fun together, getting ready to go to Wichita, you know.
Probably going to win.
12-2 us.
12-2.
Once in a lifetime. Opportunity.
Yeah?
Super stuff.
I think they'll take away that they would like to be a big leaguer someday. I think hopefully guys gain some confidence, gain a little bit of momentum. Let's just play good baseball. How's that?
To me, this is similar to our alumni game, exhibition game, for our work in. Our focus is Wichita State. Yeah, it's beautiful, man. I'm glad our guys get in this and get to see what it feels like. And my advice to them, just enjoy it, have fun. And, you know, when it's time to go out and compete on the mound, just compete, you know?
It's a great experience for the guys. Just come on out and get to play against the D-backs, the big leaguers, right? It's about experience for them today, and I think they thoroughly enjoyed it. I wish we would have played a little bit better in spurts there, but that's okay. It's about fans, our administration, our fans coming out and watching us play, and the guys get a chance to play in this beautiful stadium.
It was amazing, you know. They coming in, we got to go in the clubhouse. The clubhouse was sweet. They hooked us up with some good food and stuff, and then we got to come out here and the field is amazing. Just to see some of the big league guys like Goldschmidt playing with them. Not a lot of people can say they can do that, so it was really neat. You know, I was just thinking, just swing out a good pitch, and I just saw it and hit it, so it was cool. I don't know, I just wasn't thinking too much, but just caught up in the moment, yeah. Just caught up in the moment.
We want our program to move and get to this point where we're playing in big ballparks and regionals and super regionals and hopefully Omaha, to where the surroundings is something that they can feel comfortable in, you know, the environment. And so I think any time that you can get them in front of a bunch of people and playing against some competition that's obviously really, really good, I think it'll help us develop in the future. There's always tests in front of us, right? I feel like we did well on test number one.
Well, all the fans heading home happy here as the Lopes salvage the third game of this three-game set. The Dons still get the series victory. They won game one by a score of 13-6, and they win game two by a score of 11-8. The Lopes, though, come back here and walk it off and win this ball game 5-4. Vorhoff gets the victory, and Jenkins is saddled with the loss. But really a gutsy performance, because the Lopes are kind of going down that road again where they were going to give one away here with some defensive plays. That run that scored was an unearned run. He reached on the air. Vorhoff came in. They got the tie, but he was able to retire the side. And then just like that, the ninth inning, LaRouge, huge pinch hit double. They ended up getting the bases loaded, and Ian Evans drives him in. Michael Potter, Fletcher Lykwith, just waiting on the head coach, Andy Stankiewicz, to come up and give us a wrap of this series. But Fletcher, you know, they celebrated out there like they just won the World Series, but it's got to be a relief for these guys, because for the last few games, they felt like they had this game in hand, and they just kind of given it away. And the Dons, to their credit, have taken the games away when they had the opportunity. This one didn't happen that way. The Lopes come back and get the victory.
Yeah, they did it to St. Mary's as well. They were up in two or three of those ball games against St. Mary's, and they just gave them away at the end of games. Big plays, home runs, grand slams, late in ball games. They need to close the gap quicker and not allow these teams to come back into ball games. You can't let somebody come into the game. You can't give them the ball game. You have to let them win the game, whether that's in the first four innings, but you can't let them win the ball game in the last three pitches of the
right.
game.
Right. Well, the head coach, Andy Stankiewicz, is going to come in here and have a chat with us, and then Fletcher and I will be back to wrap everything up here for you. But the bottom line, the Lopes pound out 12 hits, score 5 runs, just a couple of errors, one of them a bit costly, but they pitch around it. For San Francisco, 4 runs on 10 hits, and they had no errors, and GCU pushes their record in this one to 4-8, and San Francisco goes to 10-6, joined by the head coach, Andy Stankiewicz. And, Coach, as you come up here and we get a chance to chat, boy, that ninth inning, it kind of almost looked like more of the same, just tough time for the bullpen to come in, and the Dons, to their credit, applying the pressure, get the game tied. But difference in this one, Mick gets out of the inning. Great leadoff double by Tom LaRouche, and you guys able to come out with a big victory.
Yeah, that was big. Obviously, it's deflating when they tie it up, but it was great to see the guys, you know, stay with it and have a game plan and not give in. You know, that's kind of development of your team, is understanding that happens, right? And you gotta punch back and you gotta shut it down. And Mick did a great job of getting us back in there, and giving us a chance to win in the ninth. And Tommy with a big time pinch hit double. Obviously that kind of gets the ball rolling. It's a great AB by him using the middle of the field. So it's a good win, no doubt. We it's a big one for us.
You know, the Dons have been applying the pressure at you guys with their speed in that ninth inning, a little bit turn of events. You get Tommy on second. You apply the pressure, put the ball in play with the bunt there. They try to go to third and just kind of forget that it's not a force play there. But it was really that speed of Tommy on second and with Bull there. And then they walk the bases loaded, probably the right call. But you got to like having Evans come up with in that situation.
Yeah, you feel good about Ian. You're not going to put the ball in play. So when they chose to do that, which like I agree with, you know, just create a force play at home. But you're right, you know, that's why, you know, we miss Tommy. You know, I'll be perfectly honest with you. You know, there's an element of speed there that we're lacking, and then with Pavlik out as well, so you've got two of our top three runners, you know, are not being able to play right now, as far as play defense. And so that's, but we got to get him healthy and look forward to that happen. In the meantime, guys got to step up and close that gap.
You know, Coach, you look at some of these scores and some of the way you've lost games, and you know, there are obviously some issues in the bullpen, middle, and you know, at the end of games. But twice now, two games in a row, the Jakes have given you some really good outings. They turned into no decisions, but those two pitching performances yesterday by Jake Wong and today by Jake Repovich were fantastic.
Yeah, it's funny. You know, Coach Dorman is new to the college game, and it's funny how he's starting to see how this thing is evolving. You know, he's starting to see that Jake Wong and Jake Repovich are just steady. They're consistent. On any given night, they can be really, really good. But we know that, but they're going to be solid. They're going to give us a good performance and let us get deep in the ball game. And so, that's what we need. That's what you need out of your starting pitching in the college game, is guys that not necessarily give you wins, but can give you 6-7 innings of work.
You know, Coach, I wanted to ask you just a couple of things. You know, you've been playing some freshmen a little more, mainly due to some of those injuries you mentioned, Preston and to Tommy. But, you know, Quiggle has been playing very well out there in center field for you. But for one moment there, we had Cotton, who got 3 hits today, which is good to see him getting going. We had Cotton at second. We had Quiggle down there at first, and you had Bess up to pinch hit. It's kind of the future, but it's kind of the present right now, too.
Yeah, it's four, and that's okay. You know, that's when they get here. You know, I don't really care if you're a freshman or a fifth-year senior. If we feel like you can help us win a ball game, you're going to get a chance to play. That's always been the way we've gone about it. You know, it's great to see those guys get some at-bats. And the more they get into it, the more they experience those moments, the more they can learn to relax in those moments, they're going to be even better players. So, yeah, really very encouraged by what they've done. Really encouraged by Mark Mumper, you know, his defense today. And I'm really excited to see that kind of hopefully continue to grow. And so it's funny, you have these non-conference games and you're trying to figure it out, and I hope that even though we have not the best record, we're starting to be able to kind of see what roles guys are going to play as we get into conference.
You know, Coach, I wanted to ask you about Mark Mumper. Got a couple of base hits, was on base 3 times today. Looked more comfortable out of short. Didn't look real comfortable yesterday, just all around. Looked more comfortable. I mean, ideally, do you like that with Baker and Malice at the corners and Mump at short and Bull at second?
I do. I think because Mark's more of a natural shortstop as far as having the arm strength and the range. And so I do think that you're right. I agree. He didn't look his first day out yesterday, maybe just a little uncertain. But today, I agree totally. He looked a lot more comfortable. And you know, I'm hoping that the more where bats he gets, and the game will kind of be able to slow down for him. But he's a skilled young man. You got drafted out of high school. You don't get drafted out of high school if you can't play. And so for him, I think it's going to be more reps and just gaining the comfortable feeling out there playing with us.
Two more things I want to ask you. One probably a good problem to have. I'll get that in a minute. But one, a problem that not sure how you're gonna do with it. But you really just haven't known who to go to out of the bullpen because it's really nobody consistent that you can figure out. What do you do with that? What's the plan going
forward?
Well,
you keep running them out there. You know, it's we feel like AJ is a senior. You know, we want to we like him. He does everything right. You know, and he's tough on righties. You know, the ball that arm angle creates a lot of sink. Mm-hmm. And so. Righties it's tough. They put some pretty good at bats against them, but you're right. We've got to find some other guys in the bullpen. Benavidez, we're ready to bring him in the game if we had to. So Gabe's going to start seeing some work out of the bullpen, and Malachi has shown spurts. You know, so it's just a matter of I think of consistency with those guys. And the more you know, and we talked about with Rich, it might be more of a get him in and have a clean inning and get him out. And sometimes you leave a guy in there, you get a little greedy, and, hey, let's get one more out of him. And maybe they're just not ready to give you two or three. Maybe they're just ready to give us one. And it may be you may see more of, you know, Andrews for one, you know, Benavidez for one, Lackey for one, and then just kind of stretched out that way.
The last one, kind of a good problem to have. You got a lefty that wants to DH and is showing he can do it, the freshman Cuba Best, and you got Greg Sines, a righty, and you got to try to figure out how to get both those guys in the lineups because they both have really good power and really good hitters for you.
Yeah, Sines has always, you know, been a not the prettiest hitter at times, but he battles, and that's always what we like to see. And so, and he does, he handles lefties pretty well. And if he's not starting, you've got a nice pinch hitter off the bench, and if Cuba's not starting, you got a nice hitter off the bench. And so what we talked about is just trying to figure out the lineup as we move forward. And so, really encouraged by both of those guys' ability to handle the bat.
Hey, Coach, congrats on the win. Nice to get the last game of the series. You guys head back out on the road. Are you excited to get back down to Pepperdine, the old stomping grounds?
That's right. It's been a long time. but, yeah, it'll be fun. It'll be fun to get back there. I'm sure it's the same. Malibu, it's a tough place to be,
huh? It's horrible out there.
Tough place to go to school, I'll tell you that.
Tough place to concentrate on school when you're in Malibu?
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
Hey, Coach, thanks a lot. Congratulations, and good luck on the road. We'll see you back here when you guys open wax season against Bakersfield.
Thanks, Mike. Appreciate it. Doing a great job.
Thank you. That's head coach Andy Stankiewicz. Fletcher will put the headsets back on and come back and wrap things up with us here. But bottom line, Lopes get the victory 5-4 to go to 4-8 on the season. San Francisco 10-6. On the year. The Lopes pound out 12 hits in this one. It is the sixth straight double-digit hit game in a row, and they'll head out on the road and try to keep that going. It wasn't pretty down the stretch necessarily with the bullpen, but they did just enough to get it done, and then the hitters brought it back for them. And Quinn Cotton, the freshman, with three base hits in this one. Mumper had a couple of base hits and a couple of RBI. And then Ian Evans, 2-for-5 with two RBI. Vorhoff gets the victory. And the Lopes, now they get to go on the road with the win under their belt. And you saw they reacted. This could be something that kind of gets them right. It gets them going in the right direction. They still got the issues. We talked to Coach Stankiewicz. They still got some pitching issues. Who's that third starter going to be? Who are you going to go to out of the bullpen? But he's starting to get kind of a logjam of offensive players where they're going to play, and that's a good problem.
Yeah, absolutely. We talked about how you need to have a complete offensive lineup from 1 to 9. Yeah. And yesterday they had only that top five. Those top five batters were solid for GCU, and today they got production from the bottom half of the lineup. Kona Quiggle, a run scored, getting on base 3 times. Jared McDonald and Cuba Best getting on base as well, scoring a run. Mark Mumper reaching base 3 times, 2 singles, and then Thomas LaRue's a 9-hole hitter that has a pinch hitter, doubles, and scores the winning run. The bottom half of the lineup produced for GCU today, and that's why they were able to come up on top.
Yeah, and just want to remind folks, we talked to Coach Stankiewicz about it, the Jakes are pitching really well. I mean, you got to have more than just starting pitching, but you look at Jake Wong yesterday, 6 innings, 6 hits, 3 runs, only one of those runs was earned, though. He walked one, struck out no one, and then when you needed somebody to come in and pitch a great game, Jake Repovich goes 7 1/3, probably could have gone more, gave up 8 hits, but scattered them, 3 runs, they were all earned, but he walked one and struck out 6, had some big strikeouts when he needed them. So you're in good shape with the Friday-Saturday guy. you got to see if Deegan Hart can kind of turn things around. It's a big jump going from JUCO to D1. But you also maybe try to get Tyler Wyatt back in the mix. But that's really the biggest issue, trying to figure out who that third starter is going to be and who's going to come out of the pen.
Yeah, absolutely. You got two workhorses, that inning eaters guys, and both Jakes, Jake Wong, Jake Repovich. They can toss a bunch of innings. They can get out of pressure situations. And if you're GCU, you're not complaining about Repovich or Wong, and you're actually really excited about them going down the long stretch if they can stay healthy, because you know that they're going to be able to produce quality performances and get quality starts for you every single time they're out on the mound. And when you get into conference play, you play some other teams that aren't as good as these West Coast Conference teams.
Right.
You're going to have opportunities to win two out of three with the Jakes on the mound to start, and then that third starter can go in there for a sweep or to pick up some innings to throw the kitchen sink at them to get some rest for the rest of the bullpen.
Well, the Lopes head out on the road. They've got at UNLV in midweek matchup, then at Pepperdine to play Pepperdine twice, Long Beach State, and then at New Mexico, back here at Brazos Stadium March 24th through 26th against Bakersfield, and that starts WAC play. The WAC's been scuffling a bit. The teams picked up at the top have really tough non-conference schedules, so they've been scuffling a bit. It'll be fun to see how the Lopes do on the road, and it'll be nice to see them back here on the 24th through 26th to play a really good Bakersfield squad to get the WAC play going.
Absolutely. It's going to be fun. WAC play is always fun to see, and it's always interesting to see who's going to come out on top in the WAC. It's always changing.
Well, hey, thanks a lot for joining us. That'll do it for us. Don't forget to follow Grand Canyon University on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/GCU. Want to thank Krista, Connor, Dewey, Taylor, Gina, and, of course, Fletcher Like for joining me, Michael Potter, and especially thanks to the communications guys up here, Josh and Jared, helping us out. Thanks for joining us. Lopes get the victory, and they head out on the road, winners winning one of three here, but get the victory tonight. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you down the road on GCU TV.